Hey, David.
Hello, Gary.
Oh, I can turn you up a little bit. This is Ham Radio Now, episode, what is it anyway? Oh, 359, an EmComm extra number 18. And I kind of waffled on what to call this. We initially were going to have one guest, and I was going to call it Force of One. There's a movie out there, an old movie, probably not a very good one, that had that name. And what we're playing off of is the ARL's publicity promotion for their work in Puerto Rico, which they called Force of 50, which actually worked out to be a Force of 22. And now we have two guests. And so, let's see, can I make this work? Come on.
Here it comes. The title.
I keep pushing the wrong button. I don't know where my title is.
There it is. There it is.
Okay. And so it is Force of Two.
One of two.
Force of Two. All right. So I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. You are?
I am David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Now you got a bunch louder on me. Okay. And Ham Radio Now is brought to you by, where did I put that?
It's Arvin. He's over here. Yeah.
Where is my Arvin? Oh, it's. Is that it?
Yeah, there he is.
There we go. Just really don't know how to make this work. Plus, it doesn't really work that well. Combination that is pretty bad. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs and stuff, just, you know, send money. Go to hamradionow.tv and click the pig. And how to make that go away. And now, gentlemen, you can unmute yourselves. And we'll do some introductions. The first guy that was going to be here is this guy here, Jeremy Dougherty, NS0S. I guess I'm going to have you sit up, Jeremy, because you're hiding behind your title.
Or tilt your camera.
Yeah, tilt your camera down a little bit. There we go.
Is that better?
Yeah, perfect. That's good. And for the audio audience, tell people who you are just a little bit. Where are you and who are you and stuff? And
my name is Jeremy Dougherty. At least my middle name is Jeremy. It's the name I go by. I live in Kansas City, Missouri, and I am a firefighter out here. I don't know what else to say. I was just with the group that volunteered to go down there.
Yep. And we will get to the details of that in just a minute, when we'll move on to part two, and that is Michael Smith, N5 TGL. And Michael, let the audio audience know what you sound like.
All right, well, good evening, everyone. Michael Smith, N5 TGL here, and I live in Fulshear, Texas. That's about 30 miles west of Houston. And just again, another one of the folks that got a chance to go on the deployment out to Puerto Rico.
All right. Back to everybody. Oops. And let's see. Do I know how to do this? No. There we go. Just our little bug now. And so that's what this show is going to be all about. That's our Force of Two. Oh, and I just got the wrong there. That's what I want. That's our Force of Two. Jeremy and Michael, two of the 22 hams that went down to Puerto Rico. And there's a lot of ways that we could structure this program. And I'm not sure that anything that I do in terms of actually a structure is going to hold very long, but let's give it a try, sort of working our way through a timeline. Hurricane Maria hit the island of Puerto Rico around September 20th, so it's been a little over a month. And as I was watching TV news and reading news in the newspapers, reading stuff online, pretty much instantly everybody reported communications had been wiped out. And when that happens, also usually pretty quickly, all the TV stations say, but we've got a report from a ham radio operator that is giving us what little information is coming from wherever the disaster is. that didn't happen in Puerto Rico. We didn't, they just kept saying no communications. Everything was out. And there probably was some ham radio communications from down there, but they weren't talking about it for very long. It took a while. And then the ARL came up with a request from the Red Cross to send some hams down there. And that's where you guys came in. How did you guys get that request? Jeremy, let's go to you first.
I was reading on Reddit, and somebody had posted a link that they the Red Cross was looking for people, and the ARL was helping them find the people to go down to Puerto Rico. And I was at the fire station when I read it, and I sent an email. I talked to my wife and asked her if she cared if I went and asked to go, and she said that would be fine. So I sent a request in, and the next day I got a call from the Red Cross or an email saying that they had selected me. And then they, within, I don't know, like 24 hours later, I was on a plane to Atlanta.
Well, that fast.
Yeah. I mean, I'm pretty sure. Was that the same with you, Michael?
Yeah, it was extremely quick. And we both found the post there on Reddit. And almost identically the same kind of thing. I sat down there and I thought about it. I was like, man, I would really like to be able to go out there and help out. And for those of you who don't know, I just went through Harvey. So we actually had evacuated and we're just getting back into our house. We had no damage and no water intrusion, but still got evacuated out of our house. So we're coming back, trying to get everything back in order. We had put everything up on the high points in the house in case we did have any kind of flooding, we didn't have a problem. So we're doing that, don't have a time to help out our local community because we're getting ourselves back together. And then this comes up. So I said, hey, this would be a great thing to go out there, see if we can't help those people out. Talked to my wife, said, man, I'm really giving this serious consideration. She says, well, you ought to go. And I was like, okay. Sent the email out on I think that Sunday night. And yeah, 2 days later, I'm on a plane to Atlanta, and we overnighted, not even 24 hours there, and then ride out to Puerto Rico after that.
What kind of qualifications did you guys present? Jason, you had said you're a fireman. What was the background that you presented?
My name's Jeremy. But they asked us, basically, the only qualification they asked, they wanted somebody to have a general class license or higher, and they wanted somebody that was okay with austerious conditions was the word they used. And they had a list of hardship codes that the Red Cross puts forward to ask, you know, if you could handle sleeping on the ground or if you're going to be okay if you don't have food and water for 24 hours. And that was, I just, you know, all those things I checked yes to, and my license class was higher than general. So that was the only qualifications they were looking for. And then they vetted us afterwards where they just asked us to fill out a health questionnaire. They had a person call me from Washington, D.C. and asked, I was only on the phone with them for like 30 seconds. They said, asked if I had any health problems. And I said, no. And they said, have you ever been to a humanitarian crisis or a disaster zone or anything like that? And I said, I had, and they asked what circumstances I was in. And I did, I was in Guatemala for a humanitarian operation with the military, but I've been to other places too. And they were like, well, you're qualified. And that was it. I got off the phone.
So your emergency qualifications were very good. Ham radio wise, you're a fairly new ham.
Mm-hmm.
About a year.
Yeah.
And
did they ask you anything about that, about what kind of experience you had, operating amateur radio?
No.
Okay.
Okay.
Interesting.
Does seem like it would be pertinent, but you know, maybe the rest of your background overrode any, you know, radio experience considerations. Now, of course, in the fire department, you've been using radios for a long time.
Yeah, and in the military. But they, I think they were asking for general classes or higher. I was in extra class, so I think I probably had the information they wanted and more.
Okay. Michael, what background did you tell them about?
So there was like kind of two levels. Initially, it was ARRL was asking us for what they were looking for, people that were, like Jeremy said, general class or higher, people that had experience with Winlink, if they had experience in bilingual, some Spanish speaking, that would be helpful. And so when I wrote the email there, I says, hey, I meet that. I have some familiarity with Winlink. I also mentioned that, you know, I was a BBA in management, traveled all over the world with my job and stuff like that. So used to different foreign cultures, different languages, conditions that are not as great. I mean, I've been out in the oil fields of Kazakhstan as well as London. So, I mean, it's got pretty wide ranging experience in there. And then I've been a licensed ham since 91. So extra class also. And I do a lot of portable operation. That's one of my kind of fun things to do. So, technical representative for my ham club and also for the battleship Texas as we're going in there and restringing the antennas for that ship. So a lot of technical experience with working with that kind of stuff.
Okay, so both of you guys had a lot of background that would be useful in a deployment like this. How much did they tell you about what to expect? They said, you know, it'll be rough, but did they give any more details? Do they have any more to give?
I didn't get any more details other than, I mean, the hardship codes were there to give you a clue of what you're to expect. And no one told us anything specific before we got there other than what we had seen ourselves on the news.
Yeah, the same thing like what Jeremy says. They give us the hardship codes there. And when you look at them and you haven't necessarily deployed with the Red Cross before, you're not – it's you don't really have a ruler to measure by how bad is that really, but you know going in there that there's limited to no power, there's limited to no water, no climate control, extreme heat, humidity, all that kind of stuff was all kind of labeled off. So I'm like, ah, this is like the Texas Gulf Coast where I live. So I said, well, it's going to be like here, but with no power and water, and that's pretty much what it is or what it was. Yeah.
Did you get a list of stuff to prepare and bring with you?
Boy, did we. both my pack and Jeremy's pack were filled to over just bursting. I packed in there with well, I think about 43 pounds of gear in my backpack, and then probably another 10 pounds in a satchel that I carried on board. So, but they said bring water, bring bug repellent. Oh, not water. I'm sorry, toilet paper, bug repellent. Stuff for, like, you know, traveler's illnesses like Imodium and that kind of stuff, changes of clothes, bring a towel, toiletries, all that other stuff. But the overriding one was do not bring any ham gear. Everything you need will be provided for you.
So none at all.
Right. So that was something that a lot of us sat down later and said, you know, this little tiny thing I have here in my hand that takes up almost zero space in my pack sure would have been handy to have.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So next time I'll take that. And I think Jeremy's got the exact same take on that too.
Yeah. I mean, I brought a couple things. I brought my own handy talkie because it doesn't take up any space. And I figured if they handed me a portable radio, I wouldn't know how to use it. So I brought my own just in case. And then the only other items, they told us to bring some food. So they told us to bring like Clif bars or protein bars, and they told us to bring a water filtration device. Like, so they're, popular name is like a life straw, so I went and bought one of those.
Okay, so as we go through this, I'll be particularly interested in, you know, what worked and what didn't, what your comments are, and I know you both got a fair number of them. So I'd like to stick to the timeline if possible, but I don't know. If that's going to hold up very well. And I'm going to divert from it to go to the after deployment for just a moment anyway, because Jeremy, one of the reasons that I got in touch with you or discovered you was a post that you had put up on Reddit. Now, you both are Reddit hams, and you both discovered the need for ham deployment by posts that came up on Reddit. When you got back, Jeremy, you put up a pretty strongly worded and strong feelings comment with the headline, please cancel your ARRL membership. You've since taken that down and put up some other stuff that we'll take a look at in a moment. But that was based on pretty much not being happy with a lot of things that went on during your deployment.
I wouldn't say I wasn't unhappy with a lot of things, but there were some specific things that I was very unhappy with.
Okay. And Michael may have a different opinion, so we'll give you guys a chance to, you know, bat it back and forth a little bit.
Sure.
So the next thing in the timeline is you're traveling. You go through what, Atlanta?
Yeah.
Yep.
And we got to Atlanta and we all stayed at this hotel in Atlanta for one night, and we spent literally the entire time we were there programming the radios or downloading applications to the laptops that they had provided. And then, like, me and another guy, we got a Red Cross credit card, and we went to Home Depot and, like, Office Max and Walmart, and we spent about $1,000 on pieces of equipment that weren't in the go kits that we needed to get, because, like, we needed enough rope to hold the antennas up. So when you multiply that by 22 people or 25 people, I mean, that was a lot of pieces of 550 cord. And then we were up until probably 11 o'clock that night programming our radios and stuff, and then we all we tried to get some sleep, and I think everybody else had to be up like at 4, but we had to be up at 3:30 a.m. to get our radio kits out. And we got some, I can't remember how we got the vehicles or how we got to the airport. I think we used like a U-Haul truck, and then we were at the airport sometime after 4 o'clock in the morning.
What radios did they provide you with?
EmComm 7200s.
And that's it?
Yes.
Okay, so no VHF radios, no.
Oh no, yeah. I mean, yeah. They had VHF handheld radios.
Okay, so you got both.
Yeah, V82s.
The 7200 is an HF only radio. Does it even do 6 meters?
I don't know.
I believe it does.
Okay, it doesn't do 2 meters.
No.
And it's the radio. I guess I should have had a picture of it here. It's the radio that EmComm designed to look like a field radio and maybe to be somewhat rugged. Was that just looks, or did it really have
some? No, it was. I don't think anybody had a radio failure at all. I mean, the radios were tough. I mean, we had them in cases to protect them, but I mean, they was those things went 5,000 miles back and forth, and we were toting them across the countryside. So, I mean, I think they're a tough radio. They stopped making them for a while, and I think that they were such a desire for them, they brought them back.
Yeah, just recently.
So I wonder what I'm sorry. No. One of the big benefits of that is that since we're doing WinLink, it also had a built-in sound card. So interface from the computer was pretty much a breeze. You just plugged in a USB cable in the back of the radio, and then you plug it into your laptop, and you're good to go. That was it. Just single cable.
Yeah.
So while you guys were on the ground there in Atlanta getting together, was there much direction in terms of you guys got together to meet to talk about, you know, what you were going to do, how you were going to do it? Or did they just turn the equipment over to you and ask you to get it all set up to do WinLink or to talk or tell me about what that was like?
We had Yeah, go ahead, Mike.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it was pretty much that. It was, we were given the rigs, the local ham club came in and dropped off some dummy loads for us so we could do an end-to-end test. So right from plugging into the wall all the way through the radio, the tuner, the laptop, all the coax, everything in line there, you know, obviously except the antenna, but that's pretty simple. And so we did that. So getting that on there, and we discovered that some people didn't have WinLink accounts set up, so we got them set up. We also discovered that some people in there weren't particularly familiar with WinLink, so we did some quickie tutorial sessions on there to help them out and get them a little better acquainted with what they're going to do. And man, I tell you, that took up to like about 1 in the morning, right, Jeremy? I mean, I just basically laid down on the cot in the in one of the conference rooms just to kind of rest my eyes, not to actually sleep, and that was about it.
Yeah, but they didn't give you like direction in terms of, you know, you're going to get there and, you know, your job was to do this and that and the other thing, or?
Well, I mean, they told us that the idea was that we would be transmitting safe and well. That was the original thing.
Yeah, my experience.
Yeah, so we would figure out, we would take information from people, their name, their address, their current location, if they're in a shelter, if they're okay, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. This all goes into a spreadsheet, which is then transmitted via HF email over to Red Cross, and then that goes in their database, and then people can check safe and well online through Red Cross and find out if everyone's okay. So that was the initial idea, is that I think we were going to go get out there, deployed with Red Cross teams. They would bring information back to us. We'd key it in, send it out, and lather, rinse, repeat, I think was the idea. Yeah. But we weren't giving any direction as to where we were going other than San Juan. That was it.
And you said there were the 22 of you. Were there other, you know, disaster care workers? Were you there with the Red Cross folks that they were shipping in, or other, you know, recovery or safety personnel? Or
yes, when we got on they had a JetBlue charter flight that took us out, and that was interesting because, you know, they had to know the weight of all the cases and the weight of all of us to make sure we wouldn't get weight limited out, and so they did all that and then basically put us on there and then filled up as many people they could get on the plane without going out of weight limit. So there were quite a few other Red Cross people on there. Well, the majority of it was, because we were just 22 folks on there, so the majority of it was other Red Cross members.
Yeah, there was probably 150 people that went down.
Yep.
I don't know, maybe more, but only 19 of us on that plane were amateur radio operators. The other three guys didn't come until a couple days to a week later.
Yep.
Did you guys have questions that you were looking for answers to before you were going down? Or
no. Wasn't any time.
No. I mean, if there was a question, it was like a technical question, how to make something work. It wasn't a question about what we were going to do down there, because no one knew, and we knew no one knew. I mean, we knew that they wanted us to fill out these spreadsheets, but we didn't know how or where or anything of that nature.
What kind of radio programming were you doing? What frequencies or radio plan did they start with?
They had none.
So what were you programming?
What do you mean programming?
Well, you said you were programming radios.
Oh.
In your Atlanta stay.
Not programming. We were programming. We were setting up the programs for the computer to make them work on. And we were... The extent of us programming the radios were, you know, making sure that we had the software set up on the radio so it would transmit, you know, just the menu settings and stuff.
Okay. And Michael, you had familiarity with WinLink. Is that true?
Yeah. I had some familiarity with WinLink. Not a ton, but it's really not a terribly difficult program. But the mainly what we did was making sure when you plug the radio in that you're seeing the right sound card and microphone setup that shows up in the WinLink program, making sure the cat control is working, making sure the push to talk control is working. And that's why those dummy loads are really handy, because we could actually sit there and, you know, key down with 5 watts out and say, yep, you were getting transmit receive switching, that's all good. And, you know, that went a long way to making us feel a whole lot better that everything was going to work when we got there.
Did you do this in one big round robin room, everybody together and able to communicate, even though you're on dummy loads?
Yep.
And how many rigs did they give you?
22 or 23? I think we had some extras.
I don't have it. I don't remember at all now at that point. I mean, there was a stack of them. There was enough for everybody to have one.
Okay. So everybody had one, and you had a VHF, a handheld or a mobile or?
Just a handheld.
Okay. I guess we get you on the airplane and get you to San Juan, and then what happens?
Well, we landed in San Juan, and we had no transportation to leave the airport. So they had us all carry our cases. And and this is not just us. This is all the Red Cross disaster people. They had us all carry everything out of the airport, and we all went to a place where we could, like, congregate, and a Red Cross guide showed up that had been on the ground there already, and he was looking for a couple of guys that could drive big trucks. So I volunteered, and I think I don't know who the other person asked to come with me who could drive a big truck, but we went to they had no plan, so we went to a rental car agency, tried to get a big truck because we had 150 people's worth of gear and radios and everything else, and all the rental trucks were gone from the city because FEMA had taken them or some other people had taken them. So we drove around, and we went to a we went past the DHL, and I said, hey, man, they got big trucks. We should see if they'd help us. So we went to DHL, and we explained the situation where we had like 150 people at the airport. We needed rides, and we had a whole bunch of equipment, and we asked DHL if they would help, and they said, sure. And they dropped what they were doing, and they sent a couple of their big package trucks over, and we loaded them up. And it was just me and like two other guys, and one of them was a ham radio guy, and the rest of the people had stayed back at the airport while we were doing that.
Yeah, you didn't need the trucks for a long, long time. Just pick up stuff at the airport, get it to the convention center?
No, we were staying at a Red Cross shelter.
Okay.
We were staying at a church that was the Red Cross was using as a shelter.
Okay, Michael, do you have anything else to add from that?
I guess my thing was it was a little bit surprising that we got there, and then they just kind of seemed to be wholly unprepared for moving us out of the airport. So, part of the problem is previous day's flights, all the flights landing at San Juan Airport were flying VFR. There was all visual approaches. So there was passenger jet aircraft that flew there, and then they were turned around. They said, no, you can't land, and they end up going back to Dominican Republic. In fact, they told us, please bring your passport with you so in case we do have to land another country to refuel, that you'll be able to get off the plane and stuff like that. So I guess there was some sort of trepidation on people not wanting to rent out a whole bunch of cars and stuff like that in case we didn't show up, but we did show up, and it took us about 4 hours to get out of the airport grounds, which was kind of surprising. To Red Cross credit, though, they did do a really nice job of getting us out, getting our bags, getting us across out to an area where we're shaded from the sun. They brought us water. They brought us food and snacks and stuff like that. So they did real well there. So they try to make us as comfortable as possible while we're waiting. But, it took a long time to kind of get us together and get us shuttled out of there. Go ahead.
When you guys got off the plane, what was it like? What was your initial impression?
So getting off the plane.
And what shape was the airport in?
Yeah.
Hot. It was just, you walked off the plane and you got into the jetway and you're like, wow, this is steamy. Now, living in the Houston, Texas area, steamy and hot is not unusual, but this was like another level of steamy and hot. It was really, it was impressive. And so you walk into the airport itself, people sitting around there fanning themselves. But basically, airport all in good repair. I don't remember seeing any broken windows. None of the shops were open or anything like that. Very, very minimal power. No lights on that I could tell. When we got down to the baggage claim, the belt was running, so that got our bags out there. But again, no fans, no air circulation, none of that. And those buildings the windows aren't built to open anymore. So very, very stifling in there. And so that was part of the deal, of like try to find a way to get out of there and so we don't get overheated within, minutes landing on the ground. After that, walked outside across the road there to kind of a gathering area and just kind of waited there for the transportation to arrive.
Which it eventually did. Jeremy, I'm going to try every J name that I know before I land on Jeremy. Sorry. So you got the DHL trucks, you got them over to the airport eventually. And it sounds like, the Red Cross had some representatives there. You guys weren't totally on your own. They were just saying that we don't know what to do yet. We're trying.
They had us sign in, and so they had a count of people. And then they were using that list to figure out how many cars they needed. I think we ended up with 26 or 28 passenger vehicles to get from the airport to the Red Cross shelter. So yeah, that took some doing to make that happen. So, we just kind of sat around and waited there.
All right. So, then your first area to go to was, Red Cross shelter.
That's correct.
So you eventually got there.
Yeah. We were originally supposed to go directly to headquarters and get some direction from them. But due to a problem, I guess, with Red Cross understanding what our role was there and it was different than other people, they made us all convoy with all the other 24 vehicles, which took us to where we didn't want to go. And then by the time we got to the shelter, we weren't really able to redirect and get back to headquarters. So that kind of killed that first day of getting a chance to talk to the guy at headquarters. But Jeremy, did Oscar come out that night when we first arrived? I'm trying to remember.
Yeah, he did. That day, by the way, real quick back to the airport thing, just flying in, I was sitting next to a pilot the whole time down, and they weren't flying the normal direction they would fly to go to Puerto Rico. They weren't flying straight there because they didn't have a way to you said there was no VFR. There was no way to direct straight there. So they flew south till they hit Puerto Rico, and then they flew along the coast. That way they didn't hit any other planes in the air or anything. And then to the point where we got the vehicles, the guy that I left with to go find some big trucks, since DHL was driving the trucks and he had to do some work, me and another person from the Red Cross group and an amateur radio operator, we got that guy's car and we left to go back to our shelter by ourselves with the DHL trucks, and the rest of the ham radio group and the Red Cross people were not with us. So we were the ones that unloaded all the gear and we set up all the cots and everything for everybody there. So what Mike saw that day and what I saw that day, we weren't in the same place most of the time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so day one was just frustrating logistics, getting someplace you didn't really want to be.
Yeah, and you know, they did give us a warning. They say, expect your first day to be really dead slow, and it lived up to that.
All right, so what happened on day two?
Well, from there, we went from the shelter to Red Cross headquarters in the morning, and got a chance to talk with Oscar a little bit further about what was going to go on. Ended up having breakfast, and then this is what kind of we're kind of vibrating in place a little bit. We're trying to figure out where we're going to go, where we're going to be sent, and that wasn't something that was immediately apparent. And again, I was a little bit kind of surprised because I figured, well, if we're when requested and we're there, then we should have the deployment lined up already. And there wasn't. So that was strange. I didn't expect that. I mean, I know that it's a fluid situation. You have to be flexible and kind of roll with the punches. But I figured that there would be some sort of thing like, so on the next day that we got there, they could say, well, you may not deploy today, but here's your assignments. First thing in tomorrow morning, you're out of here. But that didn't materialize.
What leadership are you seeing? Who's in charge here?
Well, and also on the second day, me and Mike weren't together because he went to the Red Cross headquarters, and me and other guys stayed back and watched the gear and took care of stuff at the shelter and helped clean up the shelter and organize everything there. So we weren't together that day either. But the leadership structure was somebody who was the first person to show up in Atlanta. Somebody from the Red Cross said that he was the first one there. He'd be the point of contact. And that person sort of ran with that. And they were under the assumption they were the leader or in charge of our group for a couple days.
So what were they giving you in terms of leadership? What were they doing?
Well, they didn't know what was going on. All they were was just another one of us. So they had no clue. I was a bit surprised as well, too, because, I mean, I know that it was a whirlwind for me and Mike to come from them saying they needed help to us. I mean, me and him both probably got our email saying we were going to get plane tickets at 10 o'clock at night. My flight left at 8 o'clock the next morning, and I didn't know for sure I was going until I got that email saying my plane tickets were in bail, were there. But, they had no clear direction for what they were going to do with us when we got there. And I thought they had probably 4 or 5 days to prepare since they were the ones asking for us.
So, the need based on what I've been hearing, you know, from day one, there's no communications across the island. We can't talk to hospitals. We can't talk to, fire departments and police agencies. The need was there. The need had been there for some time. So you guys are there and probably getting frustrated that you're not going out where you probably expect the need is as well. How long did that go on? How did it, how'd that log jam get broken?
I broke it. Well, would you agree with that, Mike?
I do.
You broke it? I broke it. I told Oscar, he was the ARL coordinator for Puerto Rico. He's a native Puerto Rican. He was a pretty good guy from the limited time I interacted with him. But I told him they had health teams that were going out doing health assessments and doing medical work every day. And I said, if you guys don't have any clear direction for what you want us to do, I can use my medical skills and go help the medical teams and put my services to use, you know, I mean, because I have more than one skill. And he said, well, what do you want to do? And I said, I want to come out here and do ham radio stuff. Well, we came out here to help the people. And I think that if you want to let some of us go do that, we'll do that. And he said, where do you want to go? And I said, I'm not from Puerto Rico. I'll go wherever you guys want me to go. And he says, well, we want to send me and a guy named Bobby, who's another ham radio operator. We went with Oscar and looked at a map of Puerto Rico. And we said, where do you guys need help on this island? And Bobby and Oscar talked about it. And they decided on two towns that were geographically would give us a better, you know, access to the whole island on that side. And so we could communicate back. And then he asked if I could get two volunteers to go with me. So I asked Mike and I asked a guy named Craig if they wanted to come, because we're also looking at, I was gauging the situation, like who's going to be okay to come out to this situation. Cause we had a lot of people in our group that were fairly old, and I don't know how well they would have done. Cause when we left, I mean, we really didn't have, we had no clear expectations of what we were gonna, yep. You know, we had no idea. We were literally going out into, you know, no man's land where no one had been before. No Red Cross workers had gone. No one had reported back what the situation was like on that side of the island. And we met in a little huddle, and I said, me, you, Mike, and Bobby, do you guys want to go do this? Because we're going to be by ourselves. And, you know, I mean, we had no place to sleep. We had no place to set up. All we knew was two towns we were going to go to and see if we could go to them. And Mike, Craig McVeigh and Bobby, we were all like, yeah, we can do this. We'll do it. So we went back to Oscar and say, yeah, we got our four guys. We'll do it. And he says, well, you guys can leave in the morning. So we got prepared for what we thought we needed to do. We had a little sit down and said, you know, we need to figure out what frequencies we're going to use when we go out there. So if we call for help or if we call for anything, we know that somebody's listening on this side of the radio. So we figured out a couple tactical things like that real quick. Yep. And then we went back to the shelter and got to sleep, and we left first thing in the morning.
So where you guys were set up at the command center when you first got there, did you guys set some of the rigs up that you had brought along there to at least be listening or sending out the initial health and welfare traffic at all?
So what they had done, Oscar had got coax run up to the roof there on the headquarters building that they were using, which is right next to Telemundo. So that's where that was. And so we had the ability, he had three coaxes that he ran, so we could run a HF, a local VHF for Peter, and then just have a backup. So when we arrived at the headquarters, there was no radio setup of any sort. So first task was to get some of our ham radio guys up on the roof, get them up there and set the 40-meter dipole up there, and then later on set the VHF there so we could talk back and forth at the convention center where the EOC was. So net control wasn't in place. There really wasn't radio sitting on the table. I mean, it was bare and time to get started. So we basically kind of had the team divided up into a group that would do the antenna setup, the antenna team, another one that would be working on deployment, and then the other one doing the internal setup and stuff like that in that room there. So we told them, it says, we need to know what frequency you guys are running, so when we do actually get to wherever it is we end up, that we'll be able to talk back. But, right. You know, exactly like what Jeremy said, is that we're going out there and into something that they just don't have any information on. So we're basically the four musketeers, and pretty much all said that we either all go or none of us go. So if anyone felt uncomfortable, because we weren't really sure how we were going to be received, we're happy that they see us, or like, why is it taking you so long? And so we were just kind of like, you know, trying to be aware of where we're at and understand what we're trying to do, and just keep an eye on everything. So, but everything went fine. We had no problems at all getting out there. Roads were all clear. Traffic was, what, 50 miles an hour, Jeremy? Something like that.
And did they send you? Did they send you with one of these medical teams, or did they just sent the four of you guys out on your own, or
just us
wow. four by ourselves? No Red Cross, no nothing. Just us four,
and no supplies or anything. Because I can imagine if you guys showed up, you know, and you know, this is the classic, you know, amateur radio, we're here to help thing. That you know, I guess if I had just survived this disaster, I'd be, you know, where's the water? Where's the food? Where's the, you know?
That's what we were getting. Things. That's what you're seeing on the news. Whenever the, somebody from a TV station showed up, it was like, where is everybody? You're the first people we've seen.
You know, me and Bobby packed up some fruit and vegetables that they had at the shelter for everybody to eat. And then me and Mike and Craig and Bobby all packed up two cases of water and loaded it in the back of the minivan before we left. And that was that. We didn't know we were coming back. We didn't know how far out we were going. We just knew that we'd have enough to survive.
You brought peace offerings.
I think we had an MRE we could split between the four of us or something like that. Yeah. And we did have the, they all told us to bring like 15 protein bars. So we all had, you know, those in our packs as like kind of an emergency ration if we needed it. So
they told you would bring the 15 protein bars. Was that the initial, hey, you guys are getting on a plane tomorrow, bring 15 protein bars? Was that like the sum of what they asked you to bring, or that was just for then?
No, there was actually a very long, detailed list that they sent us of all the kind of stuff that they felt we should have. And it was pretty comprehensive. And, you know, it got to the point like where I picked up my pack, and I'm like, man, what can I take out of here? Yeah. But I mean, pretty much everything that they mentioned, it was really difficult for me to say, probably don't need that. No, it was a good list. I think, I don't think there was anything in there really all that superfluous. I mean, you would go out there pretty well prepared. Now, did I use all of it? No, not at all. I mean, but any of that stuff in there, you know, when you don't know where you're ending up, it was a good list.
Yeah.
When you were getting ready to go and you were asking them, well, what frequency are we going to contact you on? Was it still, you know, everyone was scratching their head trying to figure it out, or did they have something to tell you?
No, we figured it out though. I mean, no one, I mean, when you say they, there was no they, it was us.
You were they, right?
Yeah, we were they. There was no they. So
you and the guys that were going to be, you're going to talk to back at the communication center.
Yeah, it was just you were they.
One right. of the guys.
They were kind of in the process of setting up net control. So I think they were trying to figure out who those people were. And so those people we kind of talked to, and I think that's how it was 7088 that was the original frequency, which then changed to 7085 in the Caribbean subband down there. But we went out with 88 and we just kind of went from there. Later on, they sent us a Winlink email that updated the frequencies and stuff like that. But that's where we started out.
How far did you guys go? So you guys, the four of you guys went off into the wilderness, as it were. How far did you guys go?
They dropped us off in Mayaguez, and then Jeremy, you guys got on to Yauco. Yeah.
Yeah. So we couldn't go straight across the island, because even at that point, which I think we were probably 7 days into the hurricane, it happened maybe, the mountains were completely devastated. I mean, you just, you know, the highways, the main highway that circled the island and the main city of San Juan had the roads cleared. But even if the roads were cleared, the shoulders of the highway, you would just have those two lanes. The shoulders were completely full of trees all over the place. You know, there was places where it was more clear than others, but there was a lot of places where it was, I mean, we saw a dead horse that was laying on the shoulder. So, I mean, but, we figured out the frequency, and then, we got to Mayaguez, and was it me and you that went to the fire station inside of it?
Yeah, because so this is where Jeremy's firefighter training comes in. He knows how things work with the firefighters. So we originally went to the police station in Mayaguez, and they weren't too impressed by seeing us at all. They were just like, we're busy. And well, maybe not so much like that, but you know, language barrier. I speak very little Spanish, and So Jeremy's like, man, we need to go to the fire station. There's going to be guys there. They're going to have a place to stay and all this other kind of stuff. So we went in there, just kind of knocked on the door and did the typical hi. We're amateur interrupters. We're here to help. And kind of stumbled through it all, saying what we're trying to do, provide long-distance communication, to be able to talk back to San Juan. And then the smiles started coming, and they were very happy to see us there. And they set us up in the commandante's private room, so that was actually really nice. They were going to set us in the crew room. They're like, well, this will be more private, and you can set your gear up there and all that other stuff. So they took very, very good care of us. The firefighters, the bomberos of Puerto Rico, excellent, fantastic guys, every one of them.
And I told everybody in the car before we went to the police station, I'm like, yeah, let's not go to the police station. They're not going to care. They're not going to want to help us. So. And then finally I was like, we'll go to the fire station. And we went to the fire station. Like you said, I mean, we just asked them if we told them we were with the Red Cross, what we were doing. And we asked if we could set it up. And I mean, not only were we moving to these guys' station unannounced, we had gear to bring in. We had to climb on the roof of their building and set up antennas and stuff. So we explained that. And I think that me and Mike maybe talked to them for like 10 minutes.
Yep.
And then we spent the next 3 minutes bringing in their gear. And then me and Bobby give a salute to Mike and Craig, and we left. And they were on their own. Like, that was it. They had no ride. I don't know if that at that point they had working cell phones in that town or anything. So they like we were like, okay. I mean, we felt like they were in a good situation. The guys there seemed genuine, and we were like, well, we wanted to see if we can get to the next town before it got dark out, so we weren't driving across Puerto Rico in the dark trying to find a place to sleep.
Yeah, and those guys were so welcoming to me. When I asked to get on the radio on the roof, I think you guys were pulling out of the driveway, and I was already on the roof. I mean, they just said, no problem, just go ahead and do whatever you need to do. They took us right up there, and it was great. So we set an inverted V up there, facing north south, and then later on put a NFED wire east west, and then also had a VHF vertical station on there, a VHF vertical for the base station, because Red Cross did have, that's one thing left out, is that Red Cross did have some VHF mobile rigs that we were able to get for the trip. So we both had 50 watt mobiles with us.
Yeah. When you guys first got on the radio, was there anybody there on the other end?
There was. So when we gave a shout to San Juan, I mean, we didn't hear cheering like you'd expect from Mission Control. but I imagine there was quite a few people that were relieved to hear that we had got there, got set up, and we were safe and sound in a good location. So I imagine they were a little bit nervous about just letting us run out there, but it was good. And then to later on hear Jeremy and Bobby check in too, that they were also in good shape. That was also really good to hear. So,
and once again, you were the first deployed hams.
Yeah.
And I was looking at the map here. San Juan is up here in the northeast corner. You went to Mayaguez on the far western side. Which route did you take? You take the north side through Arecibo?
Yeah, went through Arecibo. And we didn't take the highway straight around. We went to the very top corner because Bobby wanted to see what condition that airport was in, just so, because not only were we the first ones to go out as a ham radio team, we were the first ones to go out, period, for the Red Cross or whatever. So anything that we saw, we were taking notes of and taking pictures on the way, so we were acting as scouts to report that information back to the Red Cross. So we went up to the airport to make sure it was in decent shape, and then we went south to Mayaguez. And then the route that you see on the highway that goes straight from Mayaguez to Yauco is the same route we took.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So down to the south there. Is that where you ended up? Oh, sorry.
Yeah,
no, go ahead, David.
Yeah. So Jeremy and the other guy, you guys drive away and leave Mike there in the great hands of the firefighters. Where did you guys go? What was your path?
We went down that main highway that you show that curves around and goes to Yauco. We got there, and for some reason we decided that Yauco was the town to be, even though the biggest town close to that would have been what's the town south of that, Mike? Ponce. So we went to Yauco, and we drove to what looked like downtown Yauco. We found a cop, and we rolled down the window and said, hey, we're here with the Red Cross. Where's a good place for us to go? Because we didn't know where their command center was, the mayor's office, police station, anything. We had no clue. And we found we went to the fire station. We gave the same speech that we gave to the guys in Mayaguez, And we asked if we could set up, and they gave us a room to set up. And we tried to get, I mean, we were running against the daylight at that point. So me and Bobby wanted to get everything set up, and so people knew we were okay, because there was no phones that worked. And I had a slingshot I had brought with us, and me and Bobby spent about 45 minutes shooting a slingshot up in the air, because there was no trees. So we were trying to get the antenna to hang over the top of a light post in a big parking lot that was behind the fire station. We got it set up, and we called back and said we were okay. And then after we called back, and after Mike had called back, and after we had found places for us to stay on our own and done all that, they sent us a WinLink message saying that if you guys want, you can stay at the fire stations. Well, we already figured that out. We did that on our own. Like, I don't know. Like, I think maybe Mike telling them they were at a fire station, they got a hold of some firefighter captain, and he said that he'd make it work. But they did that after we had already set it up.
Well, I actually got some of the backstory on that and found out how that happened. And okay. It turns out that out in Yonke, where the search and rescue people were departing from every day, they didn't have any communications between there and San Juan. So they actually came to Red Cross asking, it says, if you give us one ham radio operator and put them there, we will give any of your ham operators shelter and food and a place to be anywhere on the island if you give us this one person. So that's where that actually came out of. I just found that out today. So that was kind of interesting. So we get there and like, oh hey, by the way, this is great. So now we knew that any bombero that we saw, any fire station, we were all set.
No, they didn't have communication, so there was like kind of a leap of faith that you'd showed up and they'd accept you, right?
Yeah, that's pretty much it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I want to ask.
Rely on your winning smile.
Yeah, I want to ask about, first of all, about your trip out. Were you isolated on the drive out? No communications? You didn't have HF mobiles, but what about VHF?
Very little VHF. There was a repeater that was operational in San Juan. There was a guy that was Morcillo, Jeremy, do you remember, or something like that? It's kind of south of San Juan. Anyway, it's west of Caguas. If you zoom in there somewhere, yeah, about where you're headed. I don't know. But anyway, so there was a guy up there, and he was a repeater, a human repeater. He was a guy up there on the mountain, and he was relaying information that he would hear on the simplex frequencies. Eventually, they got a repeater up there, but that was the only thing we got, and we were only good with that until we got out to Arecibo, and that's where pretty much we lost all communication at that point.
And that was okay. That's Arecibo is not that far from San Juan.
No, it doesn't take long to get there.
No.
Yeah, I was thinking. The island is not that big. All the way out to Mayaguez was 75 miles. It's obviously not simplex.
As the crow flies.
Right. But what's the terrain? It's somewhat mountainous.
I'd say it's very mountainous, actually.
Yep. Yeah. The middle of the island is a mountain range. And so all around the periphery of the island is where all the cities are. And then the smaller cities and towns are in the mountains. And they're just like where we were at in Mayaguez, we went to Las Marias and Maricao and Ormigueros and Cabo Rojo. Yeah, you have to go a little bit east to see Las Marias. And it should be in there somewhere, maybe a little bit pulled down. Yeah, there's Maricao. Yeah, and Las Marias out over there. So, and absolutely beautiful up there, but absolutely destroyed infrastructure. I mean, that whole route that we took from San Juan all the way down to Mayaguez, just nothing but laid over power poles, of whether they're wood, they were snapped like twigs. If they were concrete, they were just shattered and twisted in multiple places. I mean, it was just like messed up like a snake in a lawnmower. I mean, it was pretty bad because you drove over power cables and communications cables all the time because you couldn't go anywhere if you didn't. I mean, there was a lot.
Yeah. But somebody had been out clearing trees and stuff from the road.
Yeah, somebody had been. And also, like, between San Juan and Arecibo, we took some pictures. None of the trees had leaves on them.
Yep.
I mean, it's maybe 20 miles, I would say. I don't know how far that is, maybe 20 miles. But I mean, there was no leaves on any of the trees. It was just bark for all, that whole distance.
Yep. So there, you guys got set up. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
There was a ham. One of the guys that was with you guys, Way Walker, a K8EAB, who has some of the little bit of video that is out there, and he's got it on YouTube. And some of the time he spent on the road, it's not great video, but it does show, kind of what things look like, at least in the area that he was driving through. And, think you're going to see the narrow road that he's on, and it's just surrounded by devastation.
Wow.
Yeah, that's way too many leaves on there.
I don't know.
He was going up to a dam that I think was on the northeast side.
Yeah, the Guateca Dam or something like that.
Yeah, the island is, what, maybe 100, 150 miles wide, something?
About 100 miles wide.
Yeah, 100 miles wide. Like 30.
Yeah, but the entire length of the island from the east side to the west side is mountains in the center of it.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't know. So, like he said, the coastline's pretty flat, and then there's a little bit of a plains area between Mayaguez and Yauca that we went through, those kind of like just flat area. But, I mean, it was surrounded by mountains.
Okay. And if there ever had been repeaters up on them, that wasn't working anymore.
Yeah.
We didn't know what repeaters were on that island when we got there. And we knew about one that was in San Juan, and that's as far as I remember us knowing it when we left. But Mike found out about a repeater that was close to his location. He relayed that information to us and Yauco, and then we figured out how to get on that repeater when they gave us the PL codes and stuff, and PL tones, and we communicate between our distances over that.
Okay. Yeah, so you guys were all set up and on the ground, and then you guys got to talking. And so when it happened, did you guys just stay where you were in the fire stations, or were you out and about, or did they call you back, or what did the next couple of days look like?
For me and Bobby, we spent the next couple of days. By the way, when we left, that whole thing about doing the health and wellness reports kind of went around the wayside. That was just, it wasn't going to work. And we didn't have the manpower to even do it if we did. I mean, because, you know, they're just us. So there was no Red Cross workers to help us with that stuff. But we went out there, and me and Bobby met with the local community leaders, and we just started relaying traffic, you know, figuring out what was going on in our area and telling.
Yeah. So was that more like tactical travel? Like, hey, we need, you know, chainsaws and manpower and the roads are closed, or.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. I mean, we passed some other information. Like there was some messages that needed to get passed. We had a family member that son was graduating basic training, and their house had been completely destroyed in a flood. The town we were in, there was an area that got completely destroyed by flooding. I mean, really bad flooding. So, her whole house was destroyed. She lost everything she owned, but she was crying because she couldn't go to her son's basic training graduation. So we relayed that information to Red Cross to do a Red Cross message with the military, but it was mainly tactical messages and requesting stuff.
Was this all day, every day? Did you, you know, take a break at night?
We slept at night, but I mean, it was so much confusion because first they went out, they told us we're going to go out there, we're going to, you know, set up communications. And that was really basically the gist of what we were going to do.
Did not have any. These guys had not communicated pretty much beyond the distance they could shout.
Yeah, the fire station I went to had no communications at all. So we gave them our VHF rigs. The FCC had gave it like an emergency ruling where they were allowing certain simplex frequencies to be used by emergency services. So we gave them the radios that we got from the Red Cross and the ones we got from the ham kits, and we used our own personal handheld radios. So we didn't have we installed our mobile rig in the fire truck, and we gave them the two portables we had to use so they could talk amongst each other.
I mean, don't they normally have their own VHF or UHF two-way system?
Yeah. Yeah, they have a UHF 800 megahertz P25 system, just like we have back home. But
they're probably dependent on a repeater that wasn't working anymore.
Yeah, their repeater wasn't working. And also, it was a digital radio system, and I think the computers got jacked up, and you know, the talk groups were gone, so there was no way to use them.
So they didn't have a backup. Didn't have a backup for that, or if they did, didn't know how to use it.
Yeah, it, whatever the situation was, there was no radios for the fire department to use where we were at.
And I know so, that our local 800 megahertz trunk system, the police and public safety in my town has reversion to an ordinary repeater if the technical stuff dies. And sounds like they should have that, and maybe they did, but didn't know how to use it, or maybe it stopped working for one. In any case, that didn't work. And you guys show up. The term heroes is getting tossed around everywhere these days, but how much like heroes in, communications heroes did you guys become when you could said, look what we got, look what you can use?
They were just appreciative. I mean, we weren't expecting any gratitude. We were just, I'm a fireman and I knew that they needed communication and they didn't have phones or anything. Like if there was a house on fire, that meant somebody had to drive to the fire station and knock on the door and say the house was on fire. And, that fire station where I was at had two firefighters at night, two. Like, so if there was a fire, that was one guy at the pump panel and one guy going in the house by himself. And, and they had no radio communications to talk amongst each other, so we fixed that. And then, they were appreciative. We had to lock the radios out because, if they hit the VFO, they didn't know how to fix it.
Yeah. I guess what I'm at is not that they treated you like heroes. It's that they recognized what you brought and what it could do for them.
Yeah. And our me and Bobby from our location, our biggest thing was we're here to help. We don't know what you need us to do, but if you ask us to do it, we're going to do what we can. So, I mean, like there was a fire one night and it was me and one other firefighter. And I said, do you guys want help? And they said, sure. So I went with them to help put out the fire.
Yeah. So it sounds like to me, and there's some, notes in the chat room, there's folks listening. We were up to about 14 at one point. It sounds like me from like the get-go, I'm very involved in areas in our area, and when something happens and we deploy, even within the areas organization, right? And then there's the bigger picture of, there's the whole ICS, right? There's an incident commander and then they have all their groups. It sounded like even from the time you guys get together, there wasn't really any, the ARL asked you guys to step up and volunteer and the Red Cross as well, but they didn't really have any level of organization or management structure to kind of guide what happened. And I guess they're all lucky you guys stepped up and said, hey, let's go do this as opposed to sit on your thumbs. But, yeah. But I get the impression that there just wasn't, nobody from, and I don't want to say headquarters was really responsible for this, but they didn't like say, tag, you're responsible or of all the people that volunteered, I think, looking at your credentials, you're a firefighter, you have experience would be an important thing, but you think they'd be looking for people who had, Aries or Mars or Racy or one of the other experiences to say, hey, you're an EC and you have, experience working with, both the served agencies and a number of operators, in some kind of, disaster or other situation such that you could, form up a team and deploy them as they'd be needed so that they were effective.
Yeah. I think that there's when you have a team structure, there's a thing where, there's a team dynamic where you meet with each other and you start, figuring each other out. And then once you start figuring out each other out, then after you get to that point, that's when you start to really move and get things done. And we had to figure things out really quickly. I mean, we had to figure out who we could work with and who was on the same page and what was going on. And the ARL didn't send anybody down from headquarters. They were the ones that were wanting to put it together, but no one showed up. It was just us and nobody from headquarters was with us. And nobody in our group really had much experience with the Red Cross that I know of. And I think we did a good job of making it work, but
yeah. But you'd think even if it wasn't going to be ARL, and I'm not sure they're the right people to manage it or not, but there'd at least be somebody from the Red Cross that, hey, we're responsible for coordinating the communications and.
Well, David mentioned the magic words incident command, and that we've been hearing incident command for years now is a structure that is stable, is consistent, is the same from one place to another. I wouldn't expect incident command to be taking place out in Mayaguez, but in San Juan, was there a real incident command structure? And were you guys part of that?
The Red Cross had an incident command structure that was set up, and they were pretty good with what they were doing, and they had good span and control. But our group, for some reason, didn't move into that fold as well, and we didn't have a good incident command structure.
Mike, what did it look like to you?
Well, I think probably some of the things is that the thing that seemed to be the most lacking to me was interface management between ARRL and the Red Cross. I think we needed to have liaisons that were knowledgeable of what the ARRL could deliver, and there needed to be an American Red Cross liaison that would be knowledgeable of what it is they needed. And then those two people would work out how they're going to solve those problems and then report back to their people saying, right, ARRL is going to do this. The other guy tells the other team lead, excuse me, that what their marching orders are. But I didn't really see that. You basically had two organizations that were just kind of like tossed against each other, and I just didn't see a whole lot of interface management there. It would have been really nice to have someone from headquarters kind of deploy to Atlanta and be that team lead, getting us together, getting us and then deploy out with us out to the field. And at that point, that person would say, for instance, select one of the members from that team and say, right, you're the team lead and you're going to manage that. I'm now going to go switch to an interface role with American Red Cross and then work those items out. And that way you have, instead of like 10 people trying to find someone to talk to, you have one. So a lot of times there was a lot of energy being diffused because it was going out in a whole bunch of different directions as opposed to being focused at one particular person that could get us the answers. And that's the part that was kind of a bit frustrating. And it got better over time, but it did take a little bit of time for that to happen.
Did anybody step up to fulfill that, just recognizing there was that need?
I think, from my point of view, that this was a Red Cross show. And Red Cross has just been leading it. We were there to work. But I think that somebody always wants to be a leader. So somebody was stepping up. And there was somebody that tried to step up when we first got to Atlanta. But I think it was a poor decision. I mean, I don't know how that happened or what allowed that to happen. But the person that was the point of contact that decided to make the leader was a general class. It had only been a general class for a year. And he was a 19-year-old kid with no emergency management background, no emergency communications background, nothing. He was just a 19-year-old kid, and he decided he was in charge. And from what we understood, he was told that he was in charge.
Because he was the first guy that showed up.
Yeah.
So logistics, it was all 100% logistics.
Yeah. Interesting.
All right. So we've gotten you past your first couple of days, and it was chaotic. And I can see the things that were frustrating you. Let's move on down then. Yeah, you know, it was a 3-week deployment, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on down to toward the end of the first week. How long, Mike? How long did you stay in my guess?
I think we were there. It was like 7 or 8 days. I think is what we ended up being there. And while we were there, we went out to a couple of different towns in that local area. One night when we were set up there. And we had a Red Cross team kind of pay us a surprise visit. So we're like, hi, who are you? And they said, well, I'm going to be this section leader out here, and we're going to deploy out at this fire station also. And I says, okay, fair enough. So talk with him. He said, hey, could you go ahead and take a look at some of these other towns in this area? And I said, sure can. And so that's what we did. So the three towns we went to were Las Marias, Maricao, and Hormigueros, which is just south of Mayaguez. And so the idea was to go out to those towns and then talk to the mayors and the other public officials there, find out what their needs are, and take that information back to our point of operations there in Mayaguez, and then we put that in a note and sent that on to Red Cross in San Juan, which then would take it and either send it to Red Cross or send it to FEMA or PRIMA, which is the Puerto Rican version of FEMA. And so we did that. We were out there one day for doing health and welfare. I'm sorry, safe and well in Mayaguez, and that's pretty much what we did. It just kind of did that, provided communications, and at this point, we were starting to get some cell phone service starting to work. And actually, they have one cell phone provider, Claro, which did work. So in some of these towns we went to, some of these people were climbing the mountains to get to the top to get signal and get out that way. And since they were able to make that happen, I think for some of this had kind of blunted some of the need for the safe and well, because these people were able to get up there and report out. But the big needs were water. After we arrived at the fire station, about 2 hours later, the water system failed and didn't come back on for, I think, 5 days. And then, you know, getting water to that city there, I mean, it's a pretty good sized town. So getting water to them, getting water up into the mountains, the roads being very treacherous, from what you saw in Waze video, I've got a bunch of pictures too that I can share with you guys later. But yeah, that's basically what we did. We kind of ran out in those towns there until we got to the point where they says, right, we're ready for you to move on to the next one, which for me was Ponce.
But they really had you doing, you know, the whole windshield survey thing.
Right. Yeah, we were going through there, taking a look and kind of giving general reports on what that looked like, but then also interfacing with, you know, the mayors and city officials and sitting down with them and taking notes on what they needed and what were their needs and getting that transmitted back to the people that could get that moving.
It sounds like your communications locally also didn't very much exist. It was, you go out, you look, you come back, and you radio something to San Juan.
Right. Yeah. Because, one thing that was really interesting is that when I went to Maricao, they had a building there that was their center of operations, or COE, for emergencies. So I walk up there and I'm like, look at the roof, and lo and behold, there's a look to be like a high gain vertical HF antenna on the roof. And I'm like, hey, says, where's the other end of that connected to? And they're like, oh, well, it's in this room back here. And so as they're taking me back to this room, they're telling me about how they're cut off from communications. They can't talk to anyone. Well, they open this door to the room. There's this rack of communications gear, and there's a Kenwood TS-2000 sitting on a bookshelf there with a desk mic sitting on top of it.
Nobody to use it.
So I go in there, flip it on, get it on 7285, give a shout. San Juan comes right back. Hey, what do you need? So, you know, we actually went and checked the FCC records for that town. There is one general there, and there are 10 technicians. And they had both the VHF and the HF set up there, and they put their repeaters up on the mountaintop. So I think it was like 157.29 had just monster coverage over that whole area. I could talk from sitting in Mayaguez, I could talk back to Maricao. So if those technicians would have been able to get on there, they could have got out. So that was one of the things. It's like, it says, had a storm-ready plaque on the front of the building, had a communications plan nailed to the wall with handwritten notes on it, never executed.
There's a lesson for hams here about how well we understand the communications plans that are sitting on our area's websites.
Yeah.
You know, not just Puerto Rico.
Well, that's why you drill. You have to practice.
Yeah. So they must have been an HF antenna as well set up there.
Yep. Yeah. It was a multi-band vertical.
Okay. How well did 40 meters work for you guys?
Well, 40 meters across the island during the day was pretty good until you got up to about 7-8 o'clock at night, and then it didn't really work so well because 40 ended up going really long. In the morning, you really probably weren't doing too good until about 8 o'clock in the morning. And then you could kind of start getting some of the NVIS type stuff working. So for local communications, not too bad. Getting off the island, depending on how your setup was, it either worked real well or it was a bit of a challenge. But yeah, they were 40 meter monobander dipoles, and doggone things would tune anywhere, which then makes you sit there and wonder exactly what part of this setup is radiating.
Fed by coax.
You know, yeah, I know, but you know, you're in an emergency situation, right? You're gonna, whatever gets out. So, yeah, I've never been able to reliably tune a 40 meter dipole up on 17, but I'll be darned if these things didn't do it. So, but you know, they didn't have any balance on them, so I'm pretty sure it was the feed line doing most of the radiating there. But yeah. Wherever we got out, and that was how that worked. I think something like an offset or fed dipole would have been a really, really good choice. Probably would have afforded us a lot better communication abilities out rather than just the monobander.
But it sounds like there's no plan for 75 meters at night, a band that would give you better local coverage at night.
I completely agree. And yeah, there was a few kits that had 80 meter dipoles in them. We had kind of toyed with the idea of lengthening ours to be able to run on 80 meters. But since net control was sitting on 7.085, we didn't really ask to move that. But yeah, I agree with you. 80 would have been great for the nighttime and then 40 during the day. And shoot, even 80 during the day at those distances, I mean, you're talking 70 odd miles. So
yeah, probably would have been fine.
Yeah. So there was the four of you guys deployed out on the West Coast there, and I guess assumably four or six more guys running net control kind of around the clock. What about the other 10 or 12? Did they eventually get placed out amongst the island, or
they had those guys doing a safety net where they would take their they got some more VHF mobile rigs and they put them inside some minivans. And they would have crews go out on distribution teams where they would hand out food and water. And they maybe, I don't know how many teams they have at that. Maybe suppose they had five. So they had five hams, one for each team. And then they did another set of team. They were doing something where they were going out and checking on people to see if they were alive, if their family members couldn't get a hold of them. And then there were some hams that went with those guys. So I don't know, maybe 10 of the guys were doing that back in San Juan, where they would leave from San Juan every day and go to different towns and hand out food or go check on people, and they would come back to San Juan every night.
So nobody else kind of deployed out in the field for any extended period of time other than you guys who decided the second day that just wasn't working and needed to help?
No, there was a fair number of folks that were deployed out there in the field. They didn't really share that information with us. So there wasn't it would have been nice if we had like a close of business type of thing where it's like, hey, here's where everyone is. So we didn't have that information. But there was I have some pictures of maps that showed where we were deployed, and we basically kind of blanketed the entire island on there.
You'd have heard them on the net, right?
We definitely heard them.
Yeah. Mike, do you think anybody deployed up for like the first week though, other than us? Or do you think that was after that?
Yeah, you know, I really don't know when the rest of the ball got rolling. Because, you know, we were kind of involved with our own stuff, and then, you know, we heard the guys out there on the islands on Culebra.
Oh, yeah. Hell yeah. There was two other guys that – so us four left one day. The next day, later that day, separate from us, they had two guys that went to an island called Culebra. And so there were six of us that deployed. One was on a different island, and there was us four on the west side. And I think that other than that, I think most of the people stayed local until a week later when we all came back and we deployed again.
Yeah, I don't have good information on when the rest of the deployment happened.
Yeah. So after a week or so, you packed it all up and went back to San Juan?
So net control called us and they said that they wanted us to come back to San Juan because, one, we had to take a mandatory day off by Red Cross rules, where we couldn't stay anywhere for more than 10 days without having a day off. And then they also said that that they wanted us to go to different locations, more locations, and that we didn't have enough members to send out in teams. So they wanted us all to come back, and they were going to redeploy us by ourselves to different places across the island and other islands. So that happened, and then I got back with – so they made it sound like Mike and Craig weren't happy with their location to us. So we went to go get them. And they didn't even know we were there to come, or they weren't ready for us. So we're a little bit frustrated, like, well, we just drove all the way from Yauco to come get you guys. So you guys aren't even ready to go. They want us back now, like at night. So me and Bobby drove through the dark, like at 10 o'clock at night. We got back to San Juan at 11 o'clock at night. We walked inside the headquarters and we were like, hey, what the hell's going on? You guys want us to come back? And I said, well, you got to come back for a day off. And I said, really? So I asked the Red Cross director that was there, like, hey, did I have to drive all the way from Yauco to San Juan, which is like 150 miles in the dark, to have a day off tomorrow? And he said, no, you could have taken a day off where you were at. Who told you had to come all the way back to San Juan for a day off? So I had to go sleep on the floor of some church in downtown San Juan for my day off.
And then did you go back, or that's when they started deploying you elsewhere?
Well, on my day off, the FEMA or somebody had decided that they needed an antenna and a radio system set up at the main hospital in San Juan, which was basically the main hospital for the entire island. Other hospitals were running out of fuel, and they would just shut down. They'd have no fuel, no generator, nothing. And they'd load up these people in vans and buses or whatever, and they'd drop them off in San Juan unannounced, like, hey, here's 50 patients, deal with them because we can't. So they were trying to alleviate some of that. So they asked me if I could set up a radio communication at the hospital, and I asked some volunteers, some young kids that were local to Puerto Rico that were at the Red Cross Command Center. I said, hey, do you kids want to come help me set up some antenna at the hospital? And they're like, what are you going to do? And I said, I don't know. We're going to figure it out when we get there. And I explained what I wanted to do, and they're like, yeah, we're down for it. So we went to the hospital, and we talked to the hospital director and asked them if we could do it. And we hung off the side of a helicopter pad six stories up and hung up an antenna. We went across two streets in a courtyard to another building not affiliated with the hospital. And then we ran all the stuff to a trailer. And there was another radio operator that was going to handle it all once I got it set up for him. So I set it all up with the kids' help. And then that radio operator ran that station.
Okay, so you added a station communications. The main hospital in San Juan, it seems a little strange they didn't have something already going.
Well, I mean, the things that you would – I mean, I'm trying to explain this to people so they understand. I mean, you can give a doctor a satellite phone, but a satellite phone does not work in a building. And you can give every doctor on the island a satellite phone, but if you don't know the other doctor's satellite phone numbers, it doesn't really do any good at all anyway. So, I mean, right. They were giving doctors satellite phones, but they didn't know who to call with them. And, you know, even if they knew the phone number, it wouldn't get through. So, I mean, they needed something to set up between the hospitals. And, you know, if one hospital has a cell phone or a phone system that works and the other one doesn't, it really, there's no communication. Even if one, you know, you have to have both have reliable communication for it to work.
Yeah. That sounds like another general lesson, David, that just handing out equipment is not all you need to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had one. I was outside one hospital one time, and I had a doctor approach me with this a satellite phone in their hand and a really confused look, and not understanding why it was working. And they were underneath a porte cochere, right? So absolutely no view of the sky. Yeah. And I says, you got to go out through the parking lot where you got a clear view of the sky. I says, think about it like it's a GPS. If you got a clear view of the sky, it'll work fine. So they didn't get a very good educational process on how to use the equipment they were given.
I have been on many a drill where you show up and you watch them struggle for a little while to figure out how, you know, any random piece of equipment works. And I know it's hard, you know, we're there to be communicators, and every once in a while you got to go over there and say, okay, if you want to blow this inflatable tent up, you have to open the valve first, and you got to hold the pump in really tight, and it works a lot better that way.
One of the hospitals I was at, the doctor and nurses were convinced that they couldn't get on the internet because they didn't have the Wi-Fi password. It was so hard. Plus the language barrier. Try to explain to them that, listen, if you have the Wi-Fi password, it will only get you on the router. You still will not have internet access.
Yeah, because there's no internet right now.
There's no internet. So,
So did the nature of the traffic you guys were sending become more health and welfare? Michael, you were talking about safety checks. What you've got is thousands of people around you that have people other places on the island, people back on the mainland that have not heard from them in weeks, and all they know is there's devastation. One of the things about ham radio is we take messages from those people and we get them to let their families and friends know what their status is. Did any of that happen?
So the interesting part about this is, it's again, it all goes back to this logistical challenge. So you go to, for instance, we went to Maracao for a day, and we said, hey, we're going to go here. We're going to take safe and well information, and we're going to pass traffic back. And so we told the mayor there, we told anyone else, and they told, like, you know, the postman in the town to spread the word. And at that point, we kind of realized that we had a problem letting people know that we were there. You know, we got two guys, we show up, and they put us in a room where we can take people in, and they would say, what do you need next? And I said, well, we need customers. So I said, bring people to us. And that was the problem, is that you're available to pass the that kind of welfare traffic. But a lot of times people were out climbing on the higher buildings trying to find a way to get coverage on the cell phone. And even though the roads and the mountains were treacherous, you could still drive out. And I know Jeremy saw this for sure, but you'd be driving on the freeway or highway or some other road, and all of a sudden you have like 40 cars all in the line all the way down the road. And they're stopped there because that's one place where you can get cell phone coverage. So they all pull over, flashers on, a line of cars, like 40 cars long, and you'd see that scattered throughout the country as people would find coverage. So, you know, Claro was working, maybe not so much with data, but it'd be able to get text and voice out. So people had a tendency to kind of go to that to pass traffic because they could go directly to a person rather than kind of funneling it through us. So
they were scrambling for the thing they knew, as little as they got, but they knew what that was.
And we weren't the thing that they knew, and we didn't have a way of getting what we did out there on a big enough billboard to let them know that we could do this for them. So that was, I didn't have a good solution to that. Jeremy, I don't know if you've got something on that.
No, there was what he's saying is true. There was a problem with consistency in delivering, you know, a product or supplies or anything or services. They'd have a team, you know, from an organization show up to a town and say, hey, we're here today to bring you food and water and whatever you guys need. And we're going to bring these satellite dishes so you can call back home. And then they're like, and then they would show up unannounced. They would be there for 2 hours and they would leave. So everybody in the town would be like, hey, they got these people that are going to be here doing this. They show up the next day at the same place, like, hey, let's get this done. Well, the team's not coming back. They only came the one day. They didn't tell anybody they were coming. And they didn't come back the next day for the people that were expecting it. You know, I mean, it was, I don't know, it was, the communication system was horrible. And even the people, the non-for-profits or the government or anything like that, they couldn't necessarily call and say we were coming, but they wouldn't stay either. They would show up for 2 hours and then they would leave. And, you know, no one would, like you said, there was just finding customers just because people weren't expecting you. And then getting, once you get something established and in place, you know, then they decided to pull us out and move us someplace else. So they had nobody there to, you know, they tell everybody we're here and then they tell us to leave.
In all of the areas and EmComm work that you've done, is there anything that would prepare you for coming up with a plan to go into an area like this and recognize this is going to be a problem to start with?
Well, you know, it's interesting as you guys were talking about it. I think about, you know, when we do drills, and we do lots of drills every year just to get everybody out and shake the equipment down and give people experience. You know, one of the things we'll do is we'll set up an NTS table and we'll set up for health and welfare and radiograms, because, you know, that's what ARL does, radiograms, right? And I know the Red Cross does their safe and well, and everybody has their own kind of way to get a message back. And my observation of those tables is 95% just explaining what the heck it is. People don't know, people don't understand, you know, and at some point, a lot of people, it's like the light goes on. Oh, it's like you can send a telegram and you don't need anything other than this equipment. And eventually you can get a message to the other side. We don't do an awesome job of letting people know that if and when this thing happens, amateur radio is a way to take a message and move it across a state, you know, or the country. And so we spent all this time, and it sounds like you guys had the same kind of situation, like, hey, we've got a service that's here and available, and we ain't got a single customer that understands what it is enough so that they could use it.
Yeah.
I think
that in the shelters, it's one thing because the people are coming into shelters, and as part of the process of the Red Cross, they're taking your name, you know, who are you, where are you from, so we can get you on the log so we know how many people are there. And hey, by the way, do you want to get a message to someone? I don't think they do an awesome job of saying, we're going to take this out via amateur radio or whatever other, you know, method or path it's going to be, so that people understand it. They just, they want a place to sleep, and they want to, you know, a hot meal or a glass of water, or, you know, a clean place to go to the bathroom. And that message back to home is maybe, you know, an afterthought.
Yeah, that's way off on the Maslow's hierarchy there for
yeah,
sure.
Yeah.
A little bit
more eager to answer your question about the, what prepares you to do that. You know, part of the reason we drill, and I don't know if you got either of you guys, you know, participate in any of the EmComm, you know, areas or other organizations, you know, you do the drills so that part of the reason I think we do the drills is so we can shake out the people to figure out, you know, these two guys have their head on their shoulders, and when it hits the fan, we hope that they show up, or we know that we can task them down the road, you know, to promote them through the organization, to make them an, you know, an AEC or an EC, and then train them with that little bit of extra stuff so that, hey, I know, hey, I may not make it, or I may be tied up, but, you know, I got a guy like Jeremy here, or a guy like Mike there that I can rely on, that will understand we've got to set up comms, we've got to get a net going, we've got to start figuring out what are the things that need to happen and move it forward. And not everybody can do that. And in fact, it's a smaller number that can than can't.
Have they talked to you guys about doing any kind of a review?
Yeah, do you hot wash?
They said that they would be contacting us to kind of go through an online teleconference. I honestly haven't had any communication from them since we've returned back, other than the Red Cross with their kind of their mental health folks have contacted me to make sure that I have all my marbles, which I assured them I do. But that's
been
about
it. We'll be the judge of that. Well, Jeremy, you didn't wait. You have gone to your friends on Reddit and put together this, the Reddit Guide to Extreme EmComm.
Yeah.
Which is, it's not real long. It's about 30 some pages, at least so far. And it's, you know, still a work in progress. Your experience, well, sort of a guide that is based on your experience there, although it's not Puerto Rico centric. It is, you know, general good ideas for what to do in an EmComm situation. And as I was going through it, I didn't see anything that, I disagreed with it. I think that if someone has not been through extensive EmComm training, they're going to learn a lot. We talked about it's got some organizational issues right now, and you know, maybe it'll get put together so things fall into a little bit better organizational pattern, but it's a work in progress. But it's a lot of good common sense stuff and good experience. And I haven't gone through the ARL's EmComm courses. I haven't looked over a lot of recent EmComm training manuals, things like that. The ICS courses didn't teach anything like this. So if somebody's looking for just basic good ideas in case they ever get into this, then this is going to be a good thing to read. Where do they find it? It's on Reddit?
I put a link on Reddit, but I mean, it's just on my Google Docs thing. If somebody can't find it on Reddit, they can look me up on QRZ and email me and I'll send them a link. I promised myself, because they told us, and I don't know if they were gloating or what, but they made it out like we were the first ones ever to do this. We were the first ones to set up communications remotely in those kind of conditions on that kind of scale. You know, I mean, I know we've all had our days where we do our, you know, we set up our trailers and pull them out to some disaster site that has all the radios already hooked up inside. And, we would just show up with our own vehicles that have our own VHF mobile rigs already inside of them. But we didn't have that situation. So I took notes the entire time, and I took notes of the good things and the bad things and the things that I thought that we could improve upon, or the things that I thought from my background with NIMS and ICS that I thought would be in place, or my backgrounds in the military. So I just put that in there, and it's a work in progress. Like you said, it doesn't flow quite well yet, but it's not to rewrite the book on Racies or Aries or any of that stuff. It's not even set up for that. It's just for basic communication and how to go about doing it if you're going to be out there by yourself.
Yeah, I've had a busy week, but I've gotten about 3/4 of the way through it, and I think it's a great start. I made a couple notes here and there, and I'll definitely get them to you. But I think you used your time well to think about, you know, where the challenges are and what you want to do. I think this is a good, it's good and valuable.
Thank you,
Michael. So what kind of training did you start with?
I'm sorry, was that directed at me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So I did not have any training in the EmComm bit or in RACES or anything like that, and haven't been involved in any disaster deployment like this. Been involved in net control type stuff, understand that, and but beyond that, no. And that was something I fully disclosed on when I sent the email into.
Okay. So, what I heard as you guys were talking about what you had been doing was a lot of on the fly, just figuring out how to do things.
Yeah, it's kind of one of those things where, you know, if there's a leadership vacuum, people are going to step in and lead, and or they're going to try to contribute as best they can with what they can see. We were given very, very basic instructions, and basically was go out there, talk to the local mayors of these towns, find out what their needs are, report back to us. So that was really the direction that we were given. They said, and really Red Cross backed off of the Safe and Well program almost immediately because they said, you know, if you can get us information on what the immediate needs are, because it's like, for instance, insulin. Two things about Puerto Rico: some of the highest incidences of diabetes anywhere, and also you have no refrigeration, your insulin just burns up and is not useful anymore. So there's a lot of people needing insulin. Oxygen was another problem. You have two plants on there. One took a direct hit from the hurricane. The other one was just west of Ponce. Both of them were out of commission, and there is a real oxygen crisis on the island as a result of that. So with those kind of guidelines saying find out what the worst needs are and report back, that's kind of what we did. So a lot of this stuff was like you've got groundwork. I mean, we go out. In fact, I had the Captain Vale from the Mayaguez police, Mayaguez firefighters. Dang it, that's a bad one. Hello, paging Dr. Freud. Anyway, so he was basically my translator and my escort and chauffeur for the days that we were there. So he would take us around. We'd get that information. He also got a chance to see these areas too and kind of report back to his group as to what's out there and do that. So the requirements were very simple. And then we'd just write up a report, send it back to San Juan, and then they'd take care of it from there.
Do you think Yeah, go ahead, Jeremy.
I was going to say, we did that for like 2 days at first. And then on the third day, they sent us an email saying that we weren't qualified to send requests back to the Red Cross.
Yeah.
So somebody that was in Calibra was like, what do you want us to do? Sit on our butts and, you know, twiddle our thumbs? So then the next day, they sent us an email saying, oh, never mind. You guys are qualified to send us requests because all we're doing is passing information. We weren't like really making requests. We were like, this is what we see and this is what they're asking for, you know? But they told us that we weren't allowed to do that. And then the next day they said, okay, never mind. You guys are allowed to do that.
So you were in a Dilbert cartoon.
Yeah, it was a joke.
Well, so to just get toward wrapping up here, Jeremy, you did label your initial Reddit post, please cancel your ARL membership. I think I'm getting the impression of why you took that approach. Let me not put words in your mouth. What led you to feel that strongly about putting that message out?
Well, that was really a post that was made for my friends at Reddit. And it wasn't really made for the entire amateur radio world because I'm not really a part of that world. I'm not part of ARL and I'm not part of and I have a circle of people I talk to and we communicate with on internet relay chat. And we have We have similar interests. We're all similar in age. You know, we're between 20 and 40, most of us. We're young, and we have similar ideals and goals. But there were some situations that happened out there, like that I thought were horrible tactical decisions. Like, you know, you set us up in these towns in pairs, which is smart. And then after 5 or 6 days, they say, okay, well, we don't have enough of you guys. We're going to pull you guys all back to San Juan, and we're going to redeploy you. So they left these towns with, I mean, they asked us just to leave our radios in these rooms set up, like, and just leave. So that happened. And then there were some people that never deployed. They were just doing whatever they wanted to do. And they weren't helping the situation with our numbers. I didn't feel like
that, that's among the group of 22 hams that went out.
Yeah. Amongst the 22. Yeah. And then also they decided, like, okay, well, this person's going to be a FEMA coordinator. Well, I'm like, why? Well, I mean, we're here for the support of the Red Cross. Why doesn't the Red Cross had a FEMA coordinator. Why do we need a separate FEMA coordinator for the radio group that's just going to convolute things and confuse things? And
so that was coming independent individual decisions.
Yes.
Somewhat because of a leadership vacuum, I take it.
Yeah. And then there was somebody that finally showed up from the ARRL. And the Red Cross wanted to extend us and have us stay longer or have our teams replaced or something. And that guy showed up from ARL. And from what I've understood, from what was relayed to me, was that guy showed up and he had some meeting. And then the Red Cross said, okay, we're done with you guys. You guys can leave. And I think that there was somebody showed up and they thought that they were going to run the show. And the Red Cross explained to them that, no, you're here to support us. So that happened. And then there was do you want me to get into details about what happened at the very end?
I don't know what they are, so I don't know whether I want you to or not. Let's get started. Well, first of all, Michael, were you seeing this sort of confusion? You clearly saw confusion. Do you see it at this level?
Well, where I was at this point, I was out in Ponce. And, you know, we'd go through a couple of days where we weren't getting a whole lot of information coming back to us. So I'd send a request out and, you know, we wait for information to come back and they were like, well, just keep doing what you're doing. And from what I understand, the reason that we got moved to hospitals and stuff like that is because FEMA felt that it was better for us to be in those positions to relay those immediate needs back. I wasn't told that directly, but that was just kind of third party. So how much of that's true or not, I really don't want to speculate. But so that kind of stuff, as for the other people, what they were doing, you know, I wasn't there and I wasn't involved in those discussions, so I don't really have any comment on that.
You were out pretty isolated.
Well, I mean, Ponce is not exactly a small town, and what I was involved with there is that one thing they did that was very good in Ponce is that they had a meeting every day at 2 o'clock for the coalition of hospitals in the area. So like 6 different hospitals in that area. Yeah, it was right there, dead south in the middle there. Yeah, Ponce. And so that was great because all of those hospitals would come together, both the nonprofit and for-profit, and they were able to tell me, and I said, hey, guys, I can get your information and traffic back to San Juan. I can get it back to FEMA and get that stuff transmitted back. And they says, hey, that's great. So, you know, when they needed something, they'd give me a shout, and, you know, the medical director of the hospital would give me a call and say, hey, we need oxygen. How can you make that happen? So, yeah, that's kind of what I did. The other kind of machinations that was going on there, I wasn't really part of that.
Did most of that go Winlink or voice or some of each?
Some of each. It kind of depended. A lot of times, if it was like at a good time of the day, kind of midday, I'd always reach for the voice, and because it was really quick, and I'd tell them, hey, it's coming, and then I'd send it out via Winlink. After a while, Claro, which is actually Verizon, changed the roaming agreements a bit, and AT&T kind of got their act together, so I was able to use my phone as a hotspot at certain times, and so I used Telnet Winlink to get out, which was way faster. But, you know, sometimes at night, the internet would drop out, all the cell phone sites died, and I couldn't get anyone on the East Coast, so I was routing messages through Switzerland because I was getting great copy over there on 40 meters, and so I was sending to Switzerland to get it to come back to San Juan.
That's to a Winlink node in Switzerland, not an individual ham.
Yeah. Wind leak node in Switzerland. And man, I tell you, that station came back on the very first connect request just instantly. I was like, wow, that's impressive. It was better than any other one I use. So
there'll be a lot of people in the audience that hardly know what wind leak is all about. So it's a RF email system, and there are nodes around the country, around the world,
yep,
that you can connect to and forward your mail in and out of.
Yes, exactly. And what I kind of tell people simplistically is that the WinLink itself is just an email application. It works pretty much the same as Outlook or any other kind of email program that you use. Now, where the difference happens is in how you decide to actually transmit that message. So you can use Telnet, which goes through the internet, and that's quick, fast, and easy. Or you can use what we're using, which is WinMore, which then connects to the radio and then sends it out via HF traffic. And so that one works. And that was also my best way of explaining it to the hospital people and stuff like that. I say, I can send email without the internet. So if the internet's down, I can still get messages out to who you need to get them to be heard. And not only that, it's much faster. It's much more efficient. Transmitting a message via HF voice that's complex with Spanish words in it is a very painful process because you have to do everything phonetically, every single word, and then read back and all that other stuff takes forever. So WinLink was really the preferred method to send it because we knew it was right every time when it was received.
But Jeremy, you had trouble with WinLink, right?
I got WinLink to work just like as anybody else if 40 meters was open. But I mean, with WinLink, there is zero nodes in the Caribbean. The closest node is in Florida. The next closest one is in Cancun. So the closest node was, you know, thousands of miles away.
So and not so good people, during the day.
No, not at all. And then most of the people that had good luck with WinLink were using Telnet. And I mean, I think Mike even just said it. When he had an opportunity to use the internet, he used the internet. So people that say, yeah, WinLink worked great. Well, yeah, you were using Telnet. Of course it was working great.
Does WinLink let you send messages direct point to point, or do you have to go through a...
No, it does peer-to-peer, but and we I know I did, and I know other people in our group requested that NetControl set up a peer-to-peer system for us to use, and they're like, we're looking into it, but it never happened. We asked them to set up a local node, and that never happened either.
So they basically probably didn't know how.
They didn't know how.
No. So they were getting your messages as email over the internet connection they had.
They were, didn't have, they had internet the whole time, so they didn't have any of those problems. And like I said, the people that were in the field that had a good luck with WinLink, a lot of them were using Telnet and doing it over the internet. But even if you he got lucky with finding a node in Switzerland that worked, because really there's a list of a couple hundred nodes and you really have to try each one until you find that one that works. And I don't know how you found Switzerland so quick because you sent me information. Well,
I'll tell you, I used my big pie hole. Yeah. So what I did is that I got on the air at night and I said, well, let's see where the heck exactly I'm going. And so I made contacts into Ukraine, into Serbia, into Moscow. And I said, well, it looks like I'm going to go into Europe. So and that's the thing is, like, you know, WinLink has got a propagation predictor on there. Well, it told me that I said, well, it looks like maybe a 5,000-mile path, 4,800-mile path is probably a good choice. So I look at that, and it's telling me it's all in the red. It's a propagation. It was like 0 and 19, so almost as bad as you could possibly get. First time I sent it, instant hookup. But that's because I got on the air and kind of just tried to see by a sideband to see where it was going.
I think the propagation tool is worthless. I mean,
yeah, it's not very effective.
No.
There's so many times I saw ones that even here when I've got back to the States showing 100 and 100 and it doesn't connect. But one station that was really, really good for us was N5TW, November 5 Tango Whiskey. That guy out in Texas there, he had stacked beams on 20 and 17 that he rotated his stack and pointed to us. And so that way I was able to get midday communications out on 17 meters. So so that worked out, even with probably the coax doing most of the work.
Yeah, and the spectrum or the sunspot cycle not really favoring 17, so you got lucky there.
No, not so much.
Did VHF repeaters ever become a thing? I know they put up a repeater at Arecibo. I don't know how high that is.
Yes, so there's one at Arecibo. There was another one. What was that forest on the east part of the island there, Jeremy?
Oh, okay.
It was,
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Yunque, yeah. So there's like that's like the highest point in Puerto Rico. So they put one up there. So that covered the east part of the island. And then where we were on the west, there was actually one that was like right around Maricao. So that covered like Mayagüez, Las Marias, Maricao. I think you didn't quite get into Ponce, but that covered big areas, and they were linked. So I could tell they were working on getting those linked repeaters up. But I'm like, the day before I left, there was a big rainstorm, and those repeaters all went down. So I don't know if there was a landslide, because there was a lot of landslides in the mountains. And so I don't know if that was the problem. You know, the repeater, whenever it would ID, would always ID at the end with dit, dit, dit. So I don't know if it was telling us it's on emergency power or solar, and it just ran out. But yeah, those last couple of days, it was just gone. So I don't know what the status was.
So it never became useful to go back to San Juan, maybe a little bit of local?
Not to San Juan. Local, definitely, because I could talk back and forth to Yauco, because Jeremy built the tape measure Yagi there, right?
Yep. Wait, I want to
that's a story.
Put this in the little EmComm guide, too, that if you don't know, if you don't have resources, you know, you got to find them. And I got internet one day and I looked on QRZ and I said, is there anybody? I typed in Yauco in the address search and I found that there was a ham radio operator. There was more than one, but I found one. I went through and looked at like the 10 or 12 I saw, and I looked for the one that had some contacts that actually was logging stuff to see if they were an active ham, not somebody who got their license 15 years ago and never used it. I found a guy and we went to his house and there's chickens running around the street and we're like, hey, does this guy live here? And no one even knew who he was. And then the next day he showed up at the fire station and we said, hey, we need a VHF mobile rig if you could let us borrow one. And he's like, I have one, but I don't have an antenna. So, and he also, we needed a programming cable for something and he had that too. So we, me and Bobby made an antenna, a 5-element Yagi out of a tape measure and PVC pipe.
Did you bring your handbook to get the dimensions?
No. I use the math.
Oh, wow. He's real math. I'm impressed. All right. So let's math is hard.
Yeah.
All right. So you got a story of your wrap up. Something went horribly wrong.
Yeah. Well, okay. And I was going to also say just real quick on another point where we were talking about being have equipment setting up and no one knowing how to use it. The hospital I went to in Culebra had a 706 Mark II ICOM HF VHF radio, and no one had ever turned it on. The Department of Health had put it in there like 10 years ago. It had a matching tuner and a matching power supply.
Did they have an antenna?
Oh, they had a badass antenna, but no one had ever showed them how to use it. No one was even licensed to use it. And I needed a barrel connector to connect to that antenna. That antenna had been knocked down in the storm. I fixed that for them and put it back up on a mast. Then I climbed up this cliff and climbed a telephone pole on top of the cliff and hung the antenna from there. And I had brought some Dacron with me just in case I needed it, and I used it for that. And then I gave a class to the local nurses and doctor about how to use the ham radio, and I gave them the military had set up a satellite communication broadband system at the town hall, and I went down there and I downloaded a online general class and technician class guide for them to take and study and get their own licenses. But at that point, I didn't have internet where I was located at. So I called net control and say, hey, man, is there anybody on QRZ that lives in this island that I can get a part from? And like 7 hours later, they write me back. There's no one on the island that has a license. So I'm like, okay. So then I walk a mile to the military and ask to use their internet. I looked on QRZ, did one search of the island and found four people that had a license on that island. And they didn't even look. They were just like, yeah, no one has it. And then I got a golf cart ride and went up to the top of a mountain and asked this guy, the advanced class license guy, if he had a barrel connector. I mean, it's just a basic thing I didn't have, but I needed it. But yeah, it's really, the radios are pointless if you don't have anybody else how to use them.
Yeah.
So we dealt with that. And then, I wasn't happy about how they were like pulling people out and moving people around and not having anybody in place and just leaving the equipment. Cause then they were going to send somebody back. But they didn't have a plan on where or when or how. And I think that they were stretching resources thin because people were doing things that they didn't really need to do. But the island I was on was Culebra. the island that another ham radio operator was on was called Vaquez. And then there was a mainland hospital in a town called Fajardo that was the main hospital that if you were leaving that island, that was the next point of higher care. But it wasn't at the level of care like the hospital in San Juan had. And they wanted us all to pick up and leave to get our inventory, our radios, and prepare to go back. And that was 6 days before we were supposed to go back. And I'm like, well, do you guys want us to go back to San Juan and just sit there for 6 days? And I said, yeah, because we need to start pulling people out. And I'm like, well, this is actually a part of the island that's completely cut off. The water went under the ocean, and the electricity went under the ocean for 10 miles and went to Vaquez. And then the water and electricity went under the ocean from Vaquez to the island of Culebra, another 10 miles and or 15 miles or something like that. And all the power poles on Vaquez had been knocked down. All everything on the mainland had been knocked down. And the water pumping station on Vaquez that pumped the water to Culebra had been destroyed by looters after the hurricane. So they had no water, no electricity, no nothing. And the hospital I was at, the hospital generator had blown up and caught fire of one of the air conditioners, and the fuel pump had broke, and it run too fast that it just put way too many volts through it. That happened. So they were running out of a temporary clinic next door with a generator that kept going offline. And the island couldn't get – they had an island generator that couldn't get enough electricity, enough diesel to run even at night. There was two or three nights where, well, that generator broke. There was no power on the entire island. And they were like, well, we're going to pull you guys out. And they sent an email saying they were going to pull us out. And I wrote them back saying that it's a crazy situation, but a millionaire on his own showed up at the island after we had sent requests to FEMA and the Red Cross and everybody else explaining the situation on this island. And literally every day, one or two different groups would show up, and like non-for-profits or governmental groups, and say, what do you guys need? And they say, well, we need a generator. We need this and that. We're out of medications. We're running with a emergency room with one light bulb hanging off the extension cord in the center. And every day they would say, okay, well, we'll see what we can do. And then nothing would happen every day. And the doctor was getting frustrated, all these people calling and asking. Well, this millionaire shows up and he says, what do you guys want? And we say, well, we need a 80 kilowatt generator to turn our hospital back on because there's no power in the hospital. And we need medications. And we also, even if we get the power back, the hospital hasn't had power in a month. So it had grown in mold and fungus and everything everywhere from no climate control system. So we had to fix that. And the doctor that was on the island left for the weekend. She had been stuck on there by herself since the first hurricane. No one had ever came back to relieve her. So she had that weekend off. They had a temporary doctor there, and they wanted me to relay all the information to that millionaire that was there. The hospital asked me to, because I knew everything that was going on. So I told him everything we needed. And then he got on a satellite phone and said, I want you to tell everything that you just told me to the person on the phone. So put me on the phone, and it was a senator's office in the United States. So I explained everything to the senator's office of what the hospital was requesting. And I was being, it was a lot of medications that like any layman person just wouldn't understand, like the generic names and all these things and the dosages and the routes. And, you know, if it's intramuscular or IV or, you know, by mouth. And I was explaining all those things that the hospital needed. And then, I sent that information up to people at the, net control and ARL guys. And the story that was relayed to me was they thought I was doing too much good work. And they said that they thought I was outshining them. And I don't think maybe they thought that I was coordinating stuff with senators or whatever. I don't know what it was, but they were trying to, you know, beat their chest and act like they were big and in charge of FEMA. And I'm just out here on this island talking to senators. And I don't know if they got jealous of that or what, but that's what was told to me when I got back, was they were unhappy about that information, that I was doing that. Well, they'd asked for me to come back, and I said that I needed to stay until Monday to talk to the doctor about everything that had happened, because, you know, this guy was buying some serious equipment and bringing some serious equipment in, and no one was there to tell the doctor about everything that was happening. So, and also Sunday, it stormed literally the entire day. It was lightning and thundering. And my antenna was on top of a metal roof up 40 feet. And I was like, you know, it's not worth it to me to go up there and try to take this equipment down for no purpose at all other than just to get out one day earlier. So that happened. Red Cross showed up on Monday on a separate mission to bring some cases of water and set up a satellite to do Wi-Fi locally. And the staff advocate for the Red Cross showed up and he asked me what the situation was. And I explained it to him and he was like, oh, and he says, well, what have you been dealing with? And I showed him and there were some nurses that came out there too. And they're about ready to cry when they saw the conditions I was dealing with and the things we've been doing. They couldn't believe it. So that happened. He said, that's fine. You know, we can understand why you're still out here. And I said, I'd be coming back the next day. And then they left on a ferry to go back to the mainland. And like an hour later, separately, like there was no communication between that group and the ARL people. I got an email from one of the ARL members saying that they needed me back in San Juan because they wanted me to do a story with Fox News. And I'll let you guys know, I hate Fox News. So I hate them, but I'm not that party. So I hope I don't hurt anybody's feelings by saying that, but they asked me to come back because they wanted to interview Mike and Valerie and me for Fox News. And I guess it was because the stories they all had been writing about things I've been doing. And I didn't even know about these stories until my wife would tell me about them. I didn't, we find out afterwards, but they said they need me back. So I talked to the mayor and the doctor had came back that day. And I said, they want me back to do this story. And they said, well, go, because we need some help on this island really bad. And I said, okay. Well, I said, I'll see what I can do. So I hopped on the ferry, the last ferry to leave that night. And I asked somebody that was on the ferry if anybody was going to San Juan. There was always six people on the ferry. And I mean, it's literally crossing the ocean. I mean, you can see on Google Maps. So I asked if anybody was going. And they said, yeah. And they said, I said, well, can anybody... Yeah, Calibra is over to your right, up, right there. So I was there. I was in that that peninsula that's right in the center, right where it says Calibra. I was right there, and that's where the ferry kind of is. But they, I asked somebody if they could give me a ride to San Juan, and I explained what was going on. That the Fox News wanted to do a story, and the people in the town wanted to get exposure because they were so limited on materials, and. The guy agreed to give me a ride, perfect stranger. And I got out to San Juan and I asked Valerie what was going on. And she said, well, they must have saw your story on ARL's website or something. I don't know where they get this information, but they really wanted to do a story with you because there was a gas explosion and they got blown up. And I don't know, the ARL wrote a story about it. So I was like, okay, well, if that's what they want to do, you know, I really didn't want to leave. I wanted to help, but I'm here. So then... The next day at breakfast, Valerie's like, I got to tell you something. I'm like, what's that? And she's like, well, we made all that story up. And I said, what story? And I'm like, well, we made up the story about you, you know, talking to Fox News. We thought you had gone rogue. And I said, gone rogue? Like, I got a wife and kids in Kansas City. I'm not going to stay in Puerto Rico. Like, I have a life. Like, I was just here to relay information like you asked me to. I was, you know, they had something going on that I was trying to make sure it happened because it was more important to me that this hospital got power and got medications and that people got to stay alive than, you know, me just leaving a day early because you wanted inventory of radio. So they're like, well, we didn't realize that they were calling you a broken arrow and they were going to send out MPs to get you. That was what they were discussing, sending out MPs to grab me off the island. And I mean, I was at that point realizing these people were complete morons because I'm a volunteer. This is a free country. And I don't know what they were going to, what they were even coming up with these outlandish, you know, just stupid stories. So I told them that I couldn't believe they would lie to somebody in the field like that. I thought it was ridiculous. And they said, well, they were trying to get a hold of you. And I was like, how? Like, I didn't have any wind link that day, that Sunday, because the storms were horrible. And the military lost their satellites. I went down to the military's place and tried to use their Wi-Fi. Nothing worked. And I would try multiple times on the radio to get a hold of net control, and I got no answer. And Mike can probably vouch for that. Net control wasn't always there. And they shut down at 7 o'clock at night, and they left. Is that correct, Mike?
Yeah. When they were running 24-hour service for a while, but I think they did that for about a week. And then they came back and they said that they were switching back to shutting down at 7. I'm like, you still got people out in the field here, which yeah. That was a strange decision.
Mike, you weren't involved in any of this. You weren't in the area.
No, it was not. I was still in Ponce.
Yes. So, I mean, me and Mike, we had similar experiences, but at the same time, we saw things differently. We weren't in the same areas ever, other than a couple car rides together.
Yeah.
And that's the extent of us hanging out. So that happened. And I asked them, I said, you know, I mean, I don't know how you guys can ever lie to anybody. Like, oh, you don't lie to people. You don't lie to people in the field. You just, I mean, who makes these childish decisions like this? And then Mike Corey's like, Valerie made it out like it was Mike Corey's decision. And I asked Mike Corey, I said, why the hell would you do something like that to somebody? And I said, do you have any experience in emergency communication or anything like that? Because you're acting like a person that's a complete amateur. And he said, I got 15 years experience in law enforcement, which I found out is a lie. I found out that he was a security dispatcher for a private company at a community college someplace back home in Mississippi. So, and, you know, I put all that online and I put it on there for Reddit because I have a vested interest in those people. Those are the people that taught me how to do what I do with radio. And they're the people that I ask questions to, and they're a great resource. So I put it on there for them. I didn't put it out for the whole world. And they made I guess people started passing that information around, and it looked
Reddit's it was kind of worldwide. So,
yeah.
Well, but
that stuff grows.
Yeah. But Reddit might be worldwide, but the population of people that are in amateur radio that use Reddit, I would say is very minute.
Yeah. But people will see it and spread it around. It was a powerful statement, and it caught a lot of attention. It caught my attention.
It caught your attention, and it caught a lot of people's attention. And it was probably like the third highest upvoted thing ever on the amateur radio forum for them. And I got a lot of people in my inbox that were looking me up on QRZ because I didn't hide about who I was. And they were writing me emails about similar problems they've had. And I'm talking about people that are elected members of the ARL that are, you know, hold positions in certain districts. And they're like, you know, we have the same problem. Or even when I wrote the post and I didn't put anybody's name on there, they were like, well, I bet you're talking about so-and-so because this sounds exactly like something so-and-so would do.
Yeah.
And I didn't know these people. I still don't know these people. I have no membership at the ARL. I have no idea about the leadership. They talked about Valerie having some TV show. I'd never heard about it before. I didn't even know who she was. So, I mean, I no reason to make this stuff up. And I don't really care what they think. You know, it's not like I have to deal with these people every day. They don't work for the fire department here. They're not my next door neighbors. And I don't get any advantage out of, you know, talking smack on these people. You know, I had my son's orchestra concert tonight. And I mean, that's what's important to me is my kids and doing things like that. You know, this is a hobby, but
as you discovered, there is a built-in anti-ARL audience. There is a built-in pro-ARL audience, and neither one of them particularly cares whether what you're saying is true or not.
Yeah.
The folks down the middle, where you know David and I live, will listen to what you're saying. We'll probably try to go get some corroboration. We may succeed. We may not. We certainly take you at your word that you know it would be odd to come on a program like this and make up a story that's not true. But none of us except you were there. Maybe those guys will talk to us. Maybe they won't. We'll see.
I don't know, but I mean, I said it from the start. I mean, you guys can look at my Winlink account. You'll see. No one contacted me and said they were trying to get a hold of me. They didn't call my wife at home. They didn't text me. They did nothing. It was just a lie. If they were trying to get a hold of me so hard, they could have.
So at that point where you're there and you know you heard that fabrication and whatever, what was the rest of your trip like? I mean, what happened at that point? Was that it?
I'm guessing short.
Go home, or you're like, okay, send me home. Or I mean, because really, I can imagine if I were in that position, I'd be like, okay, either I'm going back out in the field, or you're putting me on a plane and I'm going home. Where were you at that point?
Well, I wasn't going to go out on the field by myself with no support. I wasn't going to just walk out back in the field and like, you know, like, hey, I'm just Jeremy Dougherty from Kansas City here to help you guys. You know, like, sure. I mean, I wasn't part of any organization if I went back at that point.
Yeah.
And I, one of the guys there, one of the volunteers that pulled me aside and said like, hey, you know, this is what happened, you know, then this is, and he's like, I don't know how you didn't just shoot somebody just now. I was like, what am I going to do? I'm like in the emergency operations center for FEMA. You want to lose my cool and just beat up somebody I don't even care about in the first place. So they were completely shocked. I kept my control together. But I told him, one of the guys that was with the ARL group said, one of the guys that was trying to, you know, do some FEMA coordination or whatever, he pulled me aside and he said, hey, can you not tell the Red Cross about what we did? And I said, why not? He said, well, we want the ARL to be able to do something with the Red Cross again in the future. And if they find out about this, they'll never want to do anything with us again. And I'm like, I could care less what you guys think at this point. You guys just lied to me. I hitchhiked across an island, across an ocean to come out here. So I said, I'm done. And they're like, what are you going to do? I said, I'm leaving. I'm done. Like, I don't trust you guys. If you're going to lie to somebody like this, like, who does this? I'm like, I'm not working with you guys anymore. You guys said I was done. You pulled me back from Culebra. You said we're packing up an inventory and our radios and leaving. I said, you got my radio already. So
were there other hams that were around that that saw this happen?
Yeah, there was. So, I mean, there was like at that point, there was probably seven of us that had came back at that point. They were all sitting right there when it happened, or eight. And I said, I'm leaving. And they're like, where are you going to go? I'm like, it doesn't matter. It's the United States. I'm a volunteer. And my deployment was over at that point anyway. So there was nothing they wanted me to do other than inventory radio. So I said, I'm leaving. And I made sure I didn't have any Red Cross gear with me. I set it on the cot, and I had a GPS device that belonged to the Red Cross. I asked them to turn it in for me, and I put my gear on my backpack, and I walked out the building and left.
So Mike, you went back to the – yeah, go ahead.
Michael, did you hear anything about this rumor whatever?
I heard about it, but it's all third-party stuff. So I wasn't in the building when that happened.
Okay. Were you in San Juan?
No, I was more likely in transit between Ponce and San Juan. I think that had already transpired and was done by the time that I actually arrived there.
So it went around as something between a story, hearsay, and rumor?
Yeah, I mean, I heard that there was a a vigorous discussion in the in that area in the shelter, and that Jeremy had left, and that was that. So didn't have a whole lot much more than that to go on.
Okay. Well, Jeremy, I'm glad that we were able to talk about all of the important stuff that you did and got to this at the end, because this kind of would have been a show killer to start with. The folks that never watched the end of a Ham Radio Now program, which is almost everybody, are going to be sorry they missed this part. They're going
to
see
exactly. You're going to stay tuned to the very end, you know?
Yeah. Going to see the...
We always hope.
Michael, do you have any wrap up? It's not going to be this. It's hard to follow that story.
No, I mean mine wasn't quite at that level. When I was in Ponce, it was kind of odd. On the very last day there, the cell phone network had actually been pretty stable, and the night before I was to go, or actually the day before I was to go, all cell providers failed. That was Verizon, Claro, AT&T, everything failed. And it was like from about 1:30 in the afternoon to about 8 or 9 o'clock at night. And so I was able to talk to the hospital coalition at that time and let them know. I says, hey, reminding you guys, I can get information and messages out. So even though we don't have any phones, this is we're not cut off. So anything you need to do, give me a shout. I'm at San Lucas Hospital, and to get to me there. They seem to have everything pretty much under control. The only thing the hospitals were really worried about was oxygen supply and being able to keep the patients they had on ventilators, that they would keep them going. So cell phone signal comes up. Next day, wake up in the morning, cell phones went out again about like 6 in the morning or something like that, and stayed out the entire time. And we had also lost the 14705 repeater that we had been using, so that was completely gone. And so it's one of these things that as you think things are progressing and are seem to be moving in a positive direction, don't think that you can't suddenly backslide, because, you know, we were fine. You know, I had AT&T 4G connection there, able to run data in and out, no problem. Repeaters working, HF working, everything's great. And then, you know, within, you know, a short span, you have no repeater, you have no cell phone network or anything like that, and you're relegated back to HF. So it was a little bit disappointing to have to pull out of there and go back. However, I will say that they've been working real well at getting those cell phone networks back up. But it was very interesting because when it went down from Ponce all the way to Yauco. That whole drive would never came back up. So it was a large area that was it was out. And so when we drove from Yauco back to San Juan along that that coastal road there, go south. Yeah, because we basically went. So Yauco is right above your logo, right there on the left. Yeah, a little bit. There it is, right there. So we went from there, followed all the way back through Ponce, just basically followed that main road all the way up until we got to what is that? Caguas up there. Yeah, that's where I finally got cell phone signal back.
Your Spanish pronunciations are getting pretty good, guys.
Yeah. So, but yeah, so that was the part that was a little bit disappointing and. I also felt that we got pulled back a little bit quick. They were trying to do an inventory, everything all out at once. My flight was on the 20th. I was in San Juan on the 17th.
Yeah, and my flight was on the 22nd, and they wanted me back on the 16th.
The story that came by real quick was that there's the button I want. The story that came back pretty quickly and briefly was that your jobs were going to be taken over by a team from Shares,
yep,
which is a quasi-government HF. Was there any interface, any overlap for you guys?
No, nothing. Zero.
Not with us.
So you pulled out of a territory that, Michael, you pulled out of a territory that things worked and then didn't. So it wasn't like you weren't always needed, but you could be at a moment's notice. And
correct. Yep.
Jeremy, and we know your story.
And they had you pack up all the stuff that was set up and working and all coordinated and box it up and check it in. And I guess either they brought their own or they had to take that stuff out and set it back up. Or?
Yeah, they were going to take it out. And from what I understand, they were going to be all deploying out to FEMA offices as opposed to deploying out to the hospitals.
I got it.
And so...
Where they were really needed most.
Yeah, the hospitals. And like the island I left off, I mean, and the island of Vieques in the Faro, no phones, no power, no water, and they pulled us out. And I was like, I mean, I don't know. It was a horrible decision.
Yeah, and you know, looking at it from what I saw, was seeing in Ponce, I mean, my view is just only of this specific area. Yeah. That hospital coalition was actually set up really well. So you had all six of the hospitals in there. You had people from their local health department there. You had FEMA attending all these meetings. So it was like one big exchange that happened at 2:00 every day. So I can kind of see how that would work because they're trying to funnel all the requests through FEMA. Because, you know, there's more than, like, we have one ham, and I was at one hospital in Ponce. So San Lucas got great coverage. All the other ones only got what they were able to exchange with me at the 2:00 meeting or by other means. So you're not able to be everything to everyone. And so, you know, I was set up in a pretty good spot there. I was able to put the dipole up between two buildings at 50 feet. So, that worked out really, really well.
Would you say that they could have used dozens and dozens more hams?
I would say yes, but I do not think they were prepared to deploy that many. So basically also what you're looking at is that they sourced that gear within like 3 or 4 days from like, hey, we might need it to. It's sitting in Connecticut and then it's sitting in Atlanta. So the fact to get all that stuff, all the Pelican cases, everything all loaded up there, that logistical movement to Atlanta was like nothing short of miraculous. And that's with 20. Now, if you wanted to double that to 50, you know, basically, I think we almost bought all the stock that DXE had.
Yeah. And it would have had to have been hams bringing their own stuff, and that would have been more of a hodgepodge.
Well, I think that was really, really good was that they issued everyone with uniform gear, uniform laptops, radios. The only thing that was a little bit different was tuners because I just think they had a lack of those. But it made it really easy for those other folks out in the field that were having trouble. We could easily troubleshoot each other because we're looking all the same stuff.
Yeah. If they had 24 or 25 rigs, you know, and sent 50 people out, that'd have been my preference if I had been deploying to tour, right? Nobody goes out on their own.
They had rigs that never left the Red Cross headquarters.
Yeah, and that's why I was going down that point before. There were probably ones that never left.
There was radios that never left. I mean, because a lot of people, they pulled, you know, a good portion of people that are doing the local VHF stuff, and they didn't have VHF radios. Yeah. The Red Cross had some they brought us, and they didn't use them. And from what I had heard, I don't know if this is true. I don't know if Mike heard the same thing. DX Engineering donated almost all that equipment. EmComm donated the other equipment. So I know those people are out there to make money, but, I mean, they put that stuff together. And they donated that stuff, and there would have been things I would have liked to have more, or radios I would have thought would have been better for certain situations. But the fact that they put that together that quick was pretty remarkable. And the fact that DX Engineering and EmComm or whoever donated that equipment, that was pretty great thing they did.
Yep, I agree.
Well, you said that you were told this was a never happened before. I don't know if it will ever happen again. It was a lot of unique situations. Puerto Rico, an island, not a good solid infrastructure to begin with. Being more wiped out than even anything around New Orleans was with Katrina. But they and the other islands are sitting there waiting for the next hurricane. It could happen again. So there's plenty of lessons here.
Haiti happened a couple of years ago.
Yeah,
Haiti's happened twice, actually, because there was the earthquake and the hurricane. But one of the things that people need to remember, too, is it's, you know, just trying to explain this to people back home, is when we lose all of our power poles in Kansas City or our lines because of an ice storm, we have Des Moines and Omaha and Oklahoma City and Houston and St. Louis and every other power company on the Midwest coming to help.
Yep.
And when you lose all those things on an island, there is no one to come and help you. I mean, you are there at your mercy to deal with those problems. So, Joplin had a bad tornado, killed a lot of people, but there was a lot of people around them. If they needed amateur radio help, people could have drove there and helped the next day on their own. And they could have brought the radios from home, but we were on an island. If we didn't bring it, we didn't have it, and we couldn't go back home 100 miles away and pick it up, because 100 miles of home was an ocean. I mean, just thinking about that, I mean, that's those people in Puerto Rico are dealing with a lot more than people are giving them credit for. I think some people are getting it, some people don't, though.
Well, I want to thank you guys for this in-depth, and we could go probably another 2 hours and find more things that come out of your memories and your experiences, and maybe we'll come revisit that some. I got a feeling, Jeremy, that your story is going to not end here.
I don't know. I mean, I got to go back to work on Saturday for the fire department, and I got my kids have a scout meeting on Monday, and I don't. What the ARL does or whatever everybody else does is their own thing. But if they want to push anything further, I mean, they can give me a call, but I'm not knocking on anybody's doors.
Yeah. Well, we'll see.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you guys. Let's see. It's, got, Jeremy Dougherty. I'm getting your name right most of the time now. NS0S here in Kansas City, and, Michael Smith, N5 TGL, and you are in what part of Texas? You down by Houston?
Yeah, I'm about 30 miles west of Houston, a little town called Fulcher, Texas.
Things pretty much recovered where you are now from Harvey?
Yeah, we were fine shape. A place about 5 miles down the road from us were just, 200 houses underwater, 12 feet of water in their homes. Maybe another 5 miles past them, an entire neighborhood was just kind of underwater. It was really pretty bad. So that was Simonton, Texas, Simonton, Simonton.
Are there still parts of the Houston, greater Houston area that are still in deep recovery?
Well, yeah, they're still trying to get rid of debris. I remember, what was it? I think last week sometime there was an announcement made that the Barker and Attucks reservoirs have finally drained of all the floodwater from Harvey just last week. Wow. So it was an astounding amount of rain. We had at my house 23 inches of rain. And I had like one day the rainfall total was, 12 to 13 inches, and I saw rain rates as high as 6 inches an hour, which is just like I mean, when there's that much rain coming out of the sky, it just, everything looks white out there. It's just a wall of white. It's yeah, it's like nothing I've seen before. It's something else.
So without going into another half hour's worth, was there much ham radio EmComm going on there? Certainly didn't hear about much.
You know, I didn't really get into it very much, because part of the thing is that dealing with Ike and dealing with and seeing Katrina and these other things here on the Gulf Coast, we've done pretty good to harden our infrastructure here. So we lost power for maybe 4 hours or something like that. We never lost cell phone service and data or a voice. We did lose internet service for I think about a day, and that was about it. And you know, this is like a 500-year storm, so the way that we're kind of set for that. And also, just to really clarify, this was a rain event. It wasn't a wind event. Now, yeah. What Puerto Rico was dealing with there was a wind event. Yeah. They had 150-mile-an-hour winds.
They had 2 feet of rain too. I mean, it was both.
It was both.
Yeah. But they didn't have 50 inches of rain. So,
down here in North Carolina, they keep trying to impress us. It's the water. It's not the wind. But when you have 180 miles an hour, it's the wind.
Well, that's the thing. Like Jeremy was saying, like to drive for 100 miles and see trees just absolutely bereft of all their foliage. I mean, just completely stripped down to the bark. Going up through some of these like little mountain passes and stuff like that, and all the trees on there are just nothing, but they just look like this. I mean, you just got sticks hanging up and nothing else. It's really something to see. So we didn't have that part. We're very lucky, but we definitely did get a good soaking from it. But all that's kind of gone away, and we're just going to have to be ready for the next one.
Yeah. Are you guys okay?
Yeah. I think we're doing pretty good. We got no water in the house. The wind gust that I had here is like 17 miles an hour. So like really nothing, but just a stupid amount of rain. It was just like 5 days of rain nonstop.
Yeah, I guess I was meaning your Puerto Rico experience. They sent you a little bit of, you know, a mental health checkup, but, there's this thing called PTSD.
Yeah. Well, I think from what I was involved with over there, I think the experience for me was about as good as it could be. I was able to help folks out. I was able to get out in those countrysides and see what's going on and try to provide some help and some comfort and all this other kind of stuff. As for me being all right, I'm nothing to complain about. I'm very happy to be here. Maybe there's some survivor's guilt going on because you're sitting there getting ready to deploy back home, and you're like, well, man, I'm going to go home to my very, very comfortable existence with all my bits and pieces and everything else I've got around me that I know and I enjoy and I love. Those people over there won't be able to escape that for better part of a year at least, and they're going to be living in very primitive conditions for quite a long time.
Yeah, I mean, it's still going on. Not much has gotten very much better.
Yeah, the electric company said that they were committed to get 95% of the communities powered by December the 15th, and I wish them all the best. And if they do that, I will be extremely happy. But if they don't, it probably wouldn't surprise me so much after seeing what I've seen. And I know, Jeremy, you've seen too much of it to count.
So. That's more than 6 weeks from now.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah. There's no way they're going to get it to that island in 6 weeks. Yeah.
So impossible. Jeremy, you are angry. I can tell. And it sounds like you have every right to be.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, it doesn't keep me up at night, but I mean, I don't know. I mean, like I said, I mean, it's not my issue. It was their issue.
It was a very strange thing to be in the middle of. And you know, there may be another side of the story, and maybe we can get that. So,
and you know what? If Mike Smith or somebody said that, well, hey, this is what you did wrong, and I was like, you know, and it happened, I'd be like, you know what? He's right. You know, I mean, I don't have anything to gain either way. You know, so I mean, I like to own up for my mistakes, and I sure don't lie to people about anything. My wife tells me I tell the truth too much, so it's just not in my nature, but. And to the question about mental health side of things, I had some pretty unique experiences happen out there that I don't think anybody else in our team had to deal with, but it's not nothing that I haven't dealt with before back home, you know? So it's just
it's your line of work.
Yeah, it's just my line of work. And I mean, I worked in a pretty rough neighborhood in Kansas City for a very long time. So, I mean, I think Kansas City's up to 160 murders so far for the year. I mean, it's just what we see down here. But I'm very happy that I got to go, and I'm happy that there was people like Mike and Craig and Bobby and the whole list of other guys that I went and worked with that were really excellent people. And that's the kind of stuff I want to remember from the trip.
Sounds like you had an amazing adventure, and probably some of it could have been better. And I hope that moving forward that, you know, the stories you guys told will make the future deployments better.
Yep, definitely hope so.
David, I'm not going to drag them through the clothes.
Okay, I got it.
There's you. There's your title there.
Yeah. And I'm David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
I am Gary Pierce, Scan4AQ. Thank you, Michael. Thank you, Jeremy.
Thank you, guys.
Over.
Yep. You're welcome.
And out.
And out. Thanks.
And feed the pig.
Feed the pig. Oh, I forgot that part.
Was that a good episode for you guys?
That was awesome. You guys rocked it.